crisp air of the Colorado Rockies, autumn is ushered in with rivalry. Kicking off the college football season with a win is important, but this is the Rocky Mountain Showdown, and bragging rights are all the motivation needed. Was decided by 1 yard.
They won't get there, and the game is over. Wow!
Today, the Rams and Buffaloes get 4 more quarters to settle the score. Colorado State, Colorado, next.
For the next 364 days, someone's going to have the bragging rights in the state of Colorado. It's been split evenly the last 6 years, but this afternoon, that tie is going to be broken. This afternoon from Boulder, Colorado, TBS Saturday Night College Football, presented by Orbis, kicks off now. And it is an absolutely spectacular day in Boulder, Colorado. We welcome you to the 77th meeting between Colorado and Colorado State. Hello again, everybody. I'm Ron Thulin, and for the fourth consecutive year, we bring you college football here on TBS. We'll bring you the best of the Pac-10 and the Big 12 for the next 10 weeks. And for the fourth consecutive year, my broadcast partner is Charles Davis. Charles, let's talk Colorado, Colorado State. Bluntly, no love lost between these two teams, but there have been some exciting games. Margin of victory the last 3 contests has been 5, but last year's game probably the most exciting ever.
And it truly cemented the rivalry, if there was any doubt, because this game came down to the last 30 seconds and it really meant Colorado State's season, because while it was the opener, when they beat Colorado, it truly means something. The first play of the sequence, quarterback Justin Holland has a chance to get it into David Anderson, 1 yard short after a terrific tackle. After a spike of the ball, Marcus Houston, the former Colorado Buffalo, unable to punch it again, and with the coaching staff frantically calling for a spike of the ball, Tristan Walker stopped by J.J. Billingsley. 30 seconds, 1 yard, Sonny Lubick's team goes down, and what it led to was a bad season for Colorado State. They went 4-7. When they win conference titles and average over 9 wins per season against Colorado. When they lose that game, bad season's result.
It is a big game for both. Now for Colorado, they come in as the defending champion in the Big 12 North. Now here's a news flash. They've won 3 of the last 4. They're picked again this year, mainly because they have 17 starters returning.
And a terrific head coach who kept the team together last year amidst a bunch of turmoil. Gary Barnett, last year's Big 12 Coach of the Year, thought he might not have a job for a while. But when he returned, he pulled the team together. They banded together, won the Big 12 North again, and went to the Houston Bowl and won that game. And he's led by a senior quarterback who is 2-0 against Colorado State and seeking to get that all-important 3rd win. And what they're looking for from Joel Klatt is his ability to manage a football game and the 2003 version of Joel Klatt. 21 touchdown passes that year. He took a step back last season. He expects to play well again this year. But Ron, this game boils down to who will be more physical. Both coaching staffs have spent all offseason talking about being physical for both of their teams. Who will be more physical in this game will tell the tale.
Well, we are expecting some offensive explosions today. Even though Colorado State has lost the last 2 meetings between these two teams, they've won the battle as far as offense, averaging more than 500 yards a game. For the fourth consecutive year, our studio host is Ernie Johnson. And Ernie Johnson, one of the great traditions in all of college football, Ralphie running onto the field here in Boulder, Colorado. EJ, good to have you back again.
Thank you, Phil. It is good to be back. And that is, as you say, certainly one of the great traditions in college football. It makes these Saturdays so special. We welcome you to another season of TBS College Football. And among the season openers today, the Sooners of Oklahoma, ranked number 5 in the nation, got a Heisman Trophy candidate in Adrian Peterson in the backfield. And they've got TCU coming to Norman, Oklahoma for the opener today. And so let's see what Paul Thompson was up to early. He's the new quarterback. The junior fumbles inside the TCU 5. and the Horned Frogs turn that into points. Later, Adrian Peterson, the Heisman hopeful, 9 yards on 9 carries in the first half. Finally, Oklahoma gets it going a little bit in the third quarter. Peterson around the right side, ties the game at, or makes it 10-7, and then Peterson takes it right up the middle. But watch out, high ankle sprain on the right side. He would leave the game, but then would return. Game tied at 10 after an Oklahoma turnover. Tie gun to Robert Merrill on the pitch. Breaks the tie, 17-10. TCU has just intercepted a pass at 17-10, nearing the midway point of the fourth quarter. Now for teams like LSU and Southern Miss and Tulane, this weekend was supposed to bring the exhilaration of a season opener. But the destruction left by Katrina has changed everything. Now it's not about competition, it's all about survival. And to all those affected by what we have seen in the Gulf, we send our prayers. And we hope that, I don't know, a little college football on the TV on a Saturday afternoon will serve as a brief respite from a situation that has gripped us all.
College football on TBS brought to you by Kia Motors, Kia, the power to surprise. By Orbitz, log on to Orbitz.com today, book your hotel and flight together and save. It's that easy. Orbitz and go. By the UPS Store, we offer the personal service your small business needs. And by Chili's, new triple dipper dinner. Come on, live a little. The campus of Colorado in Boulder, Colorado, under beautiful skies, temperature in the high 80s, expected to be as high as 93 today, a perfect day for college football. The third member of our broadcast team is going to be roaming the sidelines. Here's Craig Sager. Sags.
Colorado and Colorado State have been fighting over the Centennial Cup trophy since their first meeting in 1893. Fueling the feud in recent years, the fact that Sonny Lubick and Gary Barnett had refused to talk to each other. And now spicing things even more, the wives are involved. Last spring during a Nike retreat, the couples were thrown together on a cruise. The wives played a game of cutthroat bingo. Carol Jo Lubick, called bingo, claimed this purse as her prize. But a short time later, Mary Barnett yelled bingo. And under the rules, if you didn't like the prize that were left, you could snatch one that was already taken, which is what Mary Barnett did. The two wives have been fighting over this purse ever since. They've gotten the coaches, their husbands, to agree. The winning team gets the Centennial Cup trophy. The winning wife gets this purse. Ryan.
All right, thanks very much, Craig. And there is Gary Barnett, the outstanding coach here. You can see his record in 6 seasons, 42-33. A win today will leave him up at 78-78 in 14 seasons as a Division I head coach. And his counterpart about 50 miles up the road is Sonny Lubick in his 13th year, the winningest coach in CSU history. Even has the field named after him up in Fort Collins, Colorado. He is sort of an icon up there. And for good reason. He turned that program around and its winnings become synonymous. Colorado won the toss. They have elected to wait till the second half. Colorado State will receive. It'll be Robert Herbert and George Hill. Mason Crosby, the outstanding kicker from Georgetown, Texas, which is just about a half hour north of Austin, set to kick it away. And one of the things for Colorado State, special teams. They have had a sense of urgency this year on their special teams.
Their return game last year was not up to standards. Less than 5 yards of punt return, and the kickoff returns weren't much better. They spent a lot of time on it in the spring and in the preseason. Let's see if it pays off.
That'll be about 9 yards deep into the end zone, and Colorado State will take over first and 10 from their own 20. This is a multiple offense, features some outstanding skill players, but it starts right there with the quarterback, Justin Holland. Over 1,600 yards throwing the football last year before fracturing an ankle in game 6. He's completely healed. But Charles, at practice on Thursday, we were blown away by the strength of this young man's arm.
The strength and the accuracy and the confidence he has in his arm permeates throughout the team. His star receiver, David Anderson, number 4, is awfully happy to have him back under center.
Anderson and Osborne are split. Sonny Lubick wants to go long in one of the first 15 plays, but they'll keep it on the ground. Nnamdi O'Harry, nothing doing. Let's take a look at the rest of this offense of Colorado State. Last year they had trouble on the O-line with protection and opening the run game. We saw it there. They're much improved. Clint Oldenburg at right tackle. Expect him to play a little tight end today also. Now running the football has been a priority and for good reason, and they've turned to Nnamdi O'Hare, a transfer out of UCLA. He's a defensive back at UCLA. He's fast, but no running back since high school.
And already gone to empty set on second and long. And shifting back with O'Hare going back to the I formation. A lot of movement early from Colorado State.
And they want to diversify their passing game. Here's Anderson, the senior who had an outstanding game last year. He's going to be dumped for about a 2-yard loss. Well, this Colorado defense, they play a 4-3 attacking style. They need to get pressure from the line. And it starts with Alex Lagan, the anchor at the defensive end spot. He's a junior out of Torrance, California. The linebacking crew, this is a solid group. Could be the best they've had in a number of years. Thaddeus Washington, he's a big-time hitter out of Louisiana. In the secondary, they welcome back J.J. Billingsley at safety. Had knee surgery last year, only got to play a couple of games. Now Corey Sperry, number 80, is
right there in the slot.
That's right, keep an eye on him, he's a big one. Third down and 11. Allen from the gun out to Sperry. 6'6", crosses the 25 up to the 28. They'll mark it just a shade short. Tyrone Henderson on the stop.
They're going to try and get the ball to Corey Sperry as much as possible. He's a guy who came out of high school, terrific football and basketball player, and he has a great look about him as an athlete. Before the game, partner, you said to me, Kellen Winslow Jr.-ish in terms of body, and what we saw in practice this week, they like his potential that much also. They will have him in the slot, they'll split him out wide, they'll bring him in tight. Look for him to play a big part in the pass game today for Colorado State.
Jimmy Kaler with his gold right shoe set to kick it away. Watch Sperry. They practiced the fake punt a lot this week, and it would go to Sperry. Kaler barely gets it away. Stephon Robinson dropping back to his 20. Gets away from the first. Looks for running room to the 25, up to the 28-yard line. A 50-yard kick. About a 6-yard on the return. And Colorado will take over. Their offense was ranked 85th last year. Their quarterback, a 3-year starter, Joel Klatten. Numbers were down, as Charles mentioned. But what makes this man so special, he is another coach on the field.
And that's such a cliche in all levels of athletics, to have a coach on the field. But here it's real. 24 years old, former minor league baseball player, tremendous amount of maturity. His dad, his high school football coach. This young man is schooled in the basics of this game.
They split the backfield up, flat on the option, bad pitch. Gets away, they're going to lose a couple of yards on the play. Hugh Charles could not get the handle on it. The rest of this Colorado offense, it's a multiple offense, similar in some ways to the West Coast. Begins with their bell cow right in the middle on the line, Mark Fenton. He is a relentless blocker. Now the coaches, they're committed to 3 running backs this year. Hugh Charles just ran it. Lawrence Vickers in the lineup, and keep an eye though on Byron Ellis. He will also be playing from that running back spot.
Right away on the first play, Gary Barnett and his offensive staff show something a little different. Joel Klatt is an option quarterback in the run game. 2 runs all of last season. I bet he'll play a bigger part in that this year.
On second and 12, a little play action. This is where Klatt's dangerous. He's got running room. Up to the 40-yard line. That'll be good enough for a first down. Jeff Heretic on the stop. Yesterday we were talking to Sean Watson, their offensive coordinator, and we asked him, do you think Klatt's going to run the ball more this year? He said, yes.
Without a doubt, because he's bigger, he's stronger, comes out here, fakes the run inside, and immediately sees an opening and tucks it and goes. In the past, you would not have seen that out of Joel Klatt. He would have stayed behind the line of scrimmage, bought a little more time, and tried to find an open receiver. That is an added dimension to the Colorado offense that should pay big dividends this year.
Well, Kloffenstein, the tight end, is now in the slot, and he's in motion. They'll move him all over the place. Klatt buys some time, over the middle, pass complete, another first down inside the 40, down to the 38-yard line. Quinn Sabnewski, the backup tight end, the senior out of Granger, Iowa, picks up 22 on the play, and Klatt is in a rhythm already.
And look for the tight ends to play a big part. Right here, Sipnewski. He's going to delay a little bit and then get down to the seam, and that's where Klatt is going to find him. Terrific patience with him. Right there, goes off of 2 blocks, right into the middle. Nice throw and a good adjustment by Sipnuski. Looking inside, had to turn outside to catch the ball. Colorado on the march.
Sprague and Washington now far to the right. Patrick Williams, the redshirt freshman on the near side. High snap, Platt pulls it down. How about a little razzle-dazzle reverse? Washington over the 30, tiptoes down the sideline. They'll mark it out at the 24-yard line. Another pickup of about 14 on the play. Darrell Williams finally on the stop.
And what made it go? Watch the block on the backside by number 17, Lawrence Vickers. He'll come into play right here. See him cut him down? That allows Vance Washington, number 21, to get to the corner. He's a guy with tremendous speed, a former defensive back, recently converted to wide receiver, and they're running plays to make sure their playmakers have the ball in their hands.
Colorado wanted to dictate the tempo of this game, and thus far they've done just that. First and 10, they keep it on the ground. Charles dances his way up to about the 20-yard line. Let's get into that Colorado State defense. They're looking for toughness in their 4-3. They lacked it in 2004. The line, young guy stepping up. Keep an eye on Jesse Nading, a sophomore out of Highlands Ranch, Colorado. The linebacker spot, Jamal Howell, a senior from Fort Worth, Texas. This kid plays one way, and it's all out. And in the secondary, they've been a little dinged up in the safety spot. But the left cornerback, Robert Hebert, he is a dandy, playing well last year against CU, their best cover guy.
On the defense, 5-yard penalty, still second down.
And our referee is Tom Walker today.
You know, if you go back to our open, one of the things we touched on was being physical. That's Steve Stannard, the Colorado State defensive coordinator. They spent all spring just staying in base defense so their guys could play fast. Didn't have to think. He wanted them to regain their confidence because they were shredded last year. Over 5 yards per carry throughout the season against them. So he just wanted them to get back to trying to be tough and physical. But right now, Colorado is controlling the line of scrimmage.
Just making sure that the ball's placed at the right spot. It is on the 19-yard line. First down and 5 for Colorado. They've mixed it up with passing and running.
I'm sorry, partner. I wouldn't be surprised right here with Colorado getting a 1st and 5 after the penalty to see if they can jam it right at Colorado State and really establish the line of scrimmage. All spring long, all fall long, both coaching staff have gotten on their team about being tougher up front. Now's a chance to prove it. Take a look at the red zone numbers from last year for Colorado. 21 touchdowns, 15 field goals out of 46 possessions. All teams would like to get that number to 85% or better when they get into the red zone.
Well, they've added 6 seconds on the clock. That was the holdup. Lapp, the senior from right here in Colorado, said he put too much pressure on himself for the first half of last year. No pressure this year. Vickers moves up. Flat looking for the screen. Got it to Vickers. Penalty flag is thrown. Vickers crosses the 10-5 and he'll dance into the end zone, but there is a flag on the play. Gary Barnett is not happy because it's going to go against his Buffaloes. Last year, they were penalized a lot. They were ninth in the Big 12.
77 offense, 10-yard penalty. Second down.
They got Tyler Palumbus, the starting split tackle. Look to the left side of your screen. Right there is Palumbus. They got him for the hold. But Vickers, what about this move? He goes by, look at that, gives him the leg, takes it away, and gets to the outside and dances into the end zone. He plays the V back. He says it's for Vickers. They talk about versatility. He can block, run, and as we just saw, catch the football very well. He does it all for Colorado, just will not be the featured back running it all season long.
And he was one of the better fullbacks in the conference last year. Now they're moving them all over the place. One thing that's impressed me so far, Charles, and we talked about it yesterday, is the offensive line of Colorado. They are so athletic, and a lot's going to be determined today to see just how well they've improved. But so far, it's been impressive.
Very impressive. The penalty notwithstanding. Remember, Tyler Palumbus, who picked up the penalty, this is his first start in a Colorado uniform.
His dad led it in football and golf here.
As did his uncle in golf twice.
First down and 15. Charles shows some speed, another penalty flag. He turns the corner and doesn't get it. Coach Shaver knocks him out of bounds, but we have a penalty flag sitting right at the 30-yard line, and it's going to be another hold against the Buffaloes.
Right at the point of attack, I believe, Ron. The offensive line again trying to carve a hole. A look to the right side. I'm saying it's right in here. Take a look. Coming out, this guard right there, bang, as he pulled around. I believe that was Daniels, number 66.
Second down.
Rolling around and picking up the penalty.
Now think about it. They've already had one score called back. They had another run that got inside the 10-yard line called back.
You won't see that often out of Brian Daniels, number 66. Today is his 23rd straight start, and he has All-America potential written all over him. A terrific offensive lineman.
Well, first down and 25 now for the Buffaloes. Dusty Sprague will go out to the right. Near side is Patrick Williams. They're going to keep it on the ground. Charles looks to turn the corner again. This time, a good job by that Colorado State defense. Maybe picks up about a yard on the play. Courtney Jones and Jeff Horenick, the two linebackers coming up to make the stop. Horenick, just a redshirt freshman out of Atwood, Kansas, population about 1,200. But he's got some pretty good credentials. How about a state high school wrestling champion twice?
Two times, also won the shot put and the discus twice in the state. A very competitive young man. They could not say enough good things about him when we were in Fort Collins talking with the coaching staff. But now is when Steve Stannard's defense must take advantage of the back-to-back flags against Colorado. Second and long, they cannot afford to give up a big play here.
Second and 24. Platt buys some time, steps up, has a man wide open down the middle. It's going to be picked off at the 10-yard line. Coach Shaver has some running room, crosses the 50. Still on his feet, gets into Colorado territory down to the 35-yard line. Miles Coach Shaver, who's had a little groin pull this year with his second interception since last season, but there is a penalty flag down. Two of them, actually.
It's always tough when you get a change of possession, because when you change possession and go from a defender to a blocker, you often see flags on the field afterwards. But a great stand for Colorado State, aided by the two flags against Colorado, and they made a statement with the interception. That is huge for the confidence of the Rams.
Bring the return. Block below the waist. Number 50 on their team. 15-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down.
And with that, we'll take a timeout. 8:53 left to play in quarter number one. Colorado moving the ball, but Colorado State comes up with a big play on the interception. We're scoreless in Boulder.
No score in the first quarter here in Boulder. Joel Klatt just threw his first interception of the season, and he's going to be sick when he watches film. Why? Watch. One guy open, two guys in the middle, and then three, and he ends up having three guys open downfield, but a hit on him caused the interception for Colorado State. Coach Shaver bringing it back.
Last year, Colorado State rushed for only 44 yards in this game, and they're being stuffed right now. O'Hara got the first hit from Jordan Dizon, the sophomore out of Hawaii. Joel Klatt's going to think about that one. That's an unusual mistake for him. I mean, he doesn't make that kind of mistake.
He had three guys open on the play and didn't get a chance to really step into the throw due to the hit and the pressure that he received from the backside. That caused the ball to go high. The result, nice interception for Colorado State, and they get a big stop.
Justin Osborne now wide to the left for Colorado State. Didn't do anything their first possession. Here comes the blitz. Holland sees it and steps away from it. Looking for Osborne. Instead, dumps it underneath to Corey Sperry. The big, talented freshman, redshirt freshman out of out of Pueblo, Colorado. Sophomore, I should say. Picks up eight on the play. This is a guy that's put out about 30 pounds. He was All-State in not only football, but also basketball. You see the numbers from last year.
And those numbers will go up. I'm going to make a prediction right now. 15 receptions, he will at least triple those numbers this year. I'm projecting him for at least a 60-catch season. He and David Anderson are going to form quite a duo for Justin Holland to throw to downfield.
Third down, we'll call it four. Too many spreading people all over the place now, Colorado State. Five wide receivers out. Holland has time, steps up, rifles it right at the first down marker, complete to John Walker. They're going to give him the first down. He was over about probably about a yard and then was pushed back, so that'll be a first down. There's the arm strength of Holland. That ball never got, that ball wouldn't have gotten wet through a car wash.
Two things I noticed on the play. Back-to-back plays for the offensive line for Colorado State have been positive because they've had tremendous pass protection. The previous play almost broke down. They gave Holland enough time to scramble and find someone. The second thing, Colorado didn't bring pressure. Just brought their front four and dropped everyone else. That gave Holland time to find an open receiver.
Tried on the ground this time. Tripped up O'Harry. Last year, that's what they did. They didn't get pressure. Colorado just sat back, and the timing routes of Colorado State just picked them apart.
If you're a Colorado fan, that's one thing to keep an eye on this year. When we talked with Mike Hankwitz, the defensive coordinator, we asked him about last year versus this year. He said, last year we sat back and were conservative, and we still got shredded. His nature is to attack. Look for them to come after Justin Holland more than they're going to lay back and drop seven in the pass coverage.
Jimmy Green joins O'Harry in the backfield. Green moving around. Sets the block. O'Harry leans forward to the 45-yard line. That'll be about 3.5 yards short of the first down. Thaddeus Washington on the stop, along with J.J. Billingsley. Our first and 10 line this year is brought to you by Napa. And we'd like to welcome Napa to part of the TBS family and college football Saturday night. Glad to have you with us. That'll be the yellow line. The red line is the original line of scrimmage, for those of you wondering. Third down, we'll call it about 3.5. No pressure. Holland going deep. Has a man. George Hill, incomplete. Lorenzo Sims, who did a good job last year in that secondary for Colorado. Junior out of Fresno, California. Edison High School on the coverage.
As a defensive back, the sideline often becomes your friend, and Lorenzo Sims played it so well. Inside position on the wide receiver forced him to fade into the sideline where there was no room left to catch the football, and once he forced him out of bounds, didn't matter if he caught it anyway. Excellent coverage by Lorenzo Sims.
Colorado State will kick it again. Jimmy Kaler, sophomore from North Bend, Colorado. First attempt was about 51 yards. This one off the side of his foot won't go quite as far. And it'll be downed at the 22-yard line, only a 31-yard kick.
Can't wear a gold shoe and do that.
No. Especially when your opponent's color is gold. It's an absolutely perfect day in Boulder, Colorado, and there's the one person not at the game. They're studying. We're scoreless. We'll be back. About 25 left in the first quarter. We're scoreless with Colorado State and Colorado, along with Charles Davis and Craig Sager. I'm Ron Thulin. Glad you're spending your Saturday afternoon with us here on TBS. One of the great state rivalries. These two schools don't like each other. They split the last six games. First and 10. Ball's on the 24. Straight ahead running. Picking up about a yard. There's been a battle going on in the state of Oklahoma with TCU and OU. Here's Ernie Johnson in our studios with more.
All right, thank you, Ron. It is over in Norman. 4th and 8 for Oklahoma. Here comes the rush, and down goes Paul Thompson, and down go the Sooners. 17-10 to TCU. Shades of 1996 when the Horned Frogs went there and beat them that year. In fact, they're 3-1 in Norman, Oklahoma. Back to you, Ron.
That's the old adage, you better lose early if you're going to lose.
That's right.
That doesn't do anything, though, for Bob Stoops. Brett Bomar may be the quarterback next week. Flat throws it out of the flat. Complete to Dusty Sprague, trying to get away. Lost the football, and Colorado State's got it, I think. Yes, they do. Jamal Hall came up with it, the senior out of Fort Worth, Texas. Looked like Robert Herbert punched the ball out of Sprague's hand. Let's take a look.
As a defensive back in a one-on-one situation, you have to make the tackle.
Robert Herbert does it one better, wraps up and punches the ball free. And Jamal Hall, their high motor, high energy guy. See, Sprague doesn't get it wrapped up. Herbert punches through. And then Herenick, number 51, shakes it totally free before Hall falls on it. Colorado State, the second turnover they've gained in this game. And this time, terrific field position.
Well, we were talking to Sonny Lubick about that, that they needed to force more turnovers this year. There it is. Only 8 interceptions last year and 8 fumble recoveries. But they've got outstanding field position now on the 28-yard line. And the officials blow the whistle.
Prior to the snap, delay a game on the offense. 5-yard penalty. Repeat first down.
Now that'll push Sonny Lubick's troops back. Let's take a look at tonight's Orbit's fast and easy keys to the game.
For Colorado State, we talked about toughness. They want to establish that up front on the O-line and D-line, running the ball and stopping the run. They want to find a feature back. Nnamdi O'Harry has gotten all the carries so far, not much room to run. The quarterback, Justin Holland, needs controlled aggressiveness. Throw the check downs when necessary, but take the big ball when you've got it.
Holland throws a rope down to the 15-yard line, complete to Dustin Osborne, the junior out of La Junta, Colorado. That's a classic example of what Justin Holland can do. He throws that 15 to 18 yard out harder than anyone, I think, in college football right now.
And can throw it from the opposite hash, too. He's got so much arm, there's no part of the field that you can totally protect. A 14-yard gain on that delivery.
That's the first down for Colorado State. Ball's on the 15-yard line. Formation, O'Harry bounces outside, turns the corner inside the 10, stretches down to about the 7-yard line. Jarrett Burrell on the stop. Segs, what you have for us?
Well, Colorado's defense playing without Brian Ewu on this series. He was injured on the previous series, came to the sideline, said he felt a twinge in his knee. He wanted to go back out, but the training staff said no. He's been riding a bike on the opposite side over here, just biting at the bit to get back out there. But for precautionary reasons, they're gonna let him sit for a while.
I remember the play, Craig. He was supposed to come on a blitz and pulled up, so it appeared that Colorado wasn't bringing pressure. It was a third down pass by Colorado State.
Second down and 2, ball on the 7-yard line. O'Harry tripped up. Dropped for maybe a loss. Burrell with his second tackle of the night.
On the last play, O'Harry got more out of it than he should have. Colorado's defensive line is holding the point of attack and really pushing Colorado State back. And on that play, that's exactly what they did. They held the point of attack. Burrell from the corner slid in from the backside and made the tackle. The Colorado State offensive line has to get more punch to increase their red zone offensive numbers of last year.
Third down and 2 on the 7. On the ground. Green stopped. Let's see where they mark it. It'll be fourth down, about a yard short. Jimmy Green, the senior out of San Diego, California. He is a tough guy. Actually KO'd 2 of his own teammates in a practice this year.
And if you're Sonny Lubick, kick the field goal, I say. Yeah. I say get points right now. They have not moved them in the offensive line. Colorado's been stouter than Colorado State up front. So this is a gamble by Sonny Lubick early, counting on his O-line to get it. Let's see if they bring Justin Holland out and give him a run-pass option.
Remember, he went for fourth down at the end of the first half last year and got it. They pull forward, and it's going to be a first down. Let's see where the officials spot it. That was a big momentum changer last year. They were down 17-0, closing minutes of the half. Sonny Lubick decided to go for it, put points on the board.
And that's why he gets paid to do what he does.
That's right.
And I'm up here. But Justin Holland knew how big of a play that was for Colorado State. And sometimes as a head coach, you have to decide what to do to show confidence in your team. And that's what he did there. He said, I trust you guys. Go get me the first down. Everything probably told him to kick it, but he went against the grain.
First and goal from the 4. Green looks for the end zone. Touchdown, Colorado State. Now we've got a flag. It may be a little too much celebration. Let's see if they picked it up. No flag. How important is that to exercise the demons of the last 30 seconds last year?
Two turnovers created by your defense already, and then on the last two plays, your offensive line created holes for your running backs to run. Those are the things that Colorado State has been looking for. That's huge for them.
Devin Mark with his second extra point in his college career. His first was last year. Makes it a 7-0 game courtesy of Jimmy Green taking it in from 3 yards out. That's a good look at Chautauqua Park, part of the Flatirons. Absolutely spectacular setting. Probably the prettiest campus in college football, I'd have to say. Getting up this morning and seeing the sun come over the hills and mountains and nothing like it. And Sonny Lubick has something to smile about. Has the lead 7-0. Last year, 17-0. He was down at one point, came back to tie it at 17. This team's ready to play. And you talked physical in the opening of a game, and we saw it. Colorado on the run. Colorado State got physical. Got physical on the fourth down play. You can see with Sonny Lubick, his record when he scores first.
A lot of credit to Sonny for going for it there and showing confidence in his team, because I didn't feel like they were moving the line of scrimmage very well. And they came back and got it. Maybe just a dose of confidence from him for going for it gave them the momentum.
Now stay tuned after our game as the Atlanta Braves look to take the second game of their series against the visiting Cincinnati Reds. The Braves took game one last night 7-4. Chipper Jones homered and pitcher Tim Hudson added a triple. Jorge Sosa takes the mound for the Braves, up 4 games over the Phils in the National League East. Reds Braves next on Braves TBS Baseball.
Every year people want to count the Braves out, and every year they keep rolling. Was it 10, 11 rookies this year? They've integrated into that franchise. Phenomenal job by John Schuerholz and Bobby Cox.
They're just hanging around the Little League parks in Atlanta, picking up all those guys.
Anytime you can get a Francoeur, life is good.
Aaron Ellis is now checked in at running back for Colorado State. He's a 6-foot sophomore out of Culver City, California. This is a tough kid. You look at Charles and Ellis, the two main running backs from that tailback spot. Not only are these great athletes, these are good kids, solid students. Sonny Lubick just couldn't say enough good things about them.
And when Gary Barnett talked to us about these two, he also mentioned their roommates. How often does that happen when you have guys competing for the same job that are also great friends and understand how to carry, you know, they might have to divide carries, but they've managed to, you know, make that work for their friendship and for the team.
Said Colorado State, men Colorado. Inside of 2 minutes. Opening quarter, Sprague in motion. He has it, gets upended right as he makes the catch. A hit by Robert Herbert. Didn't have any spring drills this year because of an injury. No ill effects from that.
Watch Herbert. He sits, reads the play, does not retreat too far, and comes up and lowers the boom on Dusty Sprague. Terrific job by Robert Herbert, the corner, keeping his eyes towards the backfield, reading the play and not getting pushed deep by the outside receiver, and a terrific tackle.
Third down and 6. This will be Colorado's first attempt at a third down play. Minute 15 in the first. Alvin Barnett on the near side. 3 wide receiver set. That just swings it out. Looks like some type of running room to Hugh Charles. They wanted to get the ball to Charles on the perimeter, but he is corralled by a bunch of white jerseys.
First, Robert Herbert on one corner. Darrell Williams, who earned the job in the preseason. Watch him right here. He comes underneath the screen pass before the blocker could get to him and makes the tackle and enforces the punt for Colorado. The Colorado State Ram defense, much maligned in 2004. They're showing terrific aggressiveness here in 2005.
Here's John Torpedo Torp, the senior out of Louisville, Colorado. Number 1 in the NCAA in net punting average last year. Number 2 in overall average. He's got a strong leg. The left footer gets a spiral way back. Hits it to 10, and it gets into the end zone. 72 yards on the kick for Torp. His net average last year was 42. His average was 46. He bested that by a bunch.
You know, that's what even what Joel Klatt said. He says, when we've got guys like Torp back there and our field goal kicker, Mason Crosby, it's like putting a warm blanket around them because they know they can get them out of trouble. Tonight's Scholar Athlete of the Game are brought to you by TIAA Cref, David Anderson of Colorado State. He has a 3.2 GPA in speech. And Ben Carpenter from Colorado, a finance and pre-med major, 3.9 GPA, and he's from Des Moines, Iowa. Congratulations, gentlemen.
And David Anderson does not have a catch thus far in this game.
Out of flat, Anderson's first reception. The senior out of Westlake Village, California.
So you talk about someone, they listen,
yep,
get him the ball. The idea from Dan Hammerschmidt, the offensive coordinator, was to get Anderson a touch in the first four plays of the game. Didn't happen, but now they'll start finding him.
Well, Torp hit a career-long punt of 72 yards. Colorado State has the football. They're trying to move. One quarter in the books. Opening game of the 2005 season, and Colorado State leads Colorado by a touchdown. Welcome back to TBS Saturday Night College Football presented by Orbis. And as we get set to start the second quarter, Colorado State leading Colorado 7-0. Along with Charles Davis and Craig Sager, I'm Ron Doolin. Ernie Johnson is in our studios in Atlanta. Glad you're with us today. Sellout crowd here at Folsom Field in Boulder, Colorado. Over 53,000 on hand. Colorado State snuffed a Colorado drive in the opening quarter, courtesy of a Koshaver interception. They were the first one to add points on the board. O'Hare gets away, tries to show some of the speed everybody talks about. J.J. Billingsley with his first stop of the afternoon. That'll be a first down for Colorado State. Let's check in with Craig Sager.
Well, Ron, you're talking about Namdi O'Hare, who always wanted to be a running back, spent 2 years at UCLA as a defensive back and also on special teams. Actually, 2 years ago in the spring, he moved to offense. He was set to be in their offensive backfield, and then UCLA recruited a guy by the name of Maurice Drew. He saw the writing on the wall. Yeah. Decided it's time to transfer.
Well, that's a great point, Craig, because Tyler Ebell felt Maurice Drew's presence and transferred to UTEP, where he's playing this year.
Well, we have some movement on the line. I'm not sure if it was Albert Bimper, the center for Colorado State, or Colorado jumped off. Once again, Tom Walker, our referee today.
Prior to the snap, false start on the offense, number 77, 5-yard penalty, big first down.
You know, Colorado State, Sonny Lubick's team, they just play hard. They play hard-nosed football. They do it the right way. And they're one of the least penalized teams in college football. They only had about 4 penalties a game last year. And already this afternoon, they're nearing that mark.
Well, part of that, I think, is the emotion of trying to shake off last year.
Mm-hmm.
4-7 is not normal for them. You know his team was jacked up to the maximum coming into today.
Our little play action pass. Has some time, looking deep, just throws it away. Smart move by the senior. He was outside of the tackles, won't be grounded.
Very intelligent play by the senior, Justin Holland. But what people have to understand about his senior status, he sat behind Bradley Van Pelt for a number of years, became the starter last year as a junior, but was unable to finish the season due to the broken leg. Got about 6 full games in. So really, as a senior, he hasn't played as often as you might imagine. And Sonny Lubick's had great success with senior quarterbacks. The worst record, Bradley Van Pelt, 7-5, but he's one of the legendary players in Colorado State history.
A great game last night for the Broncos. Big first hit by Thaddeus Washington. That's the kind of thumper that you like to see on Colorado if you're Mike Hankwitz, Ryan Cabral, the linebacker coach.
Yeah, Thad the Impaler coming from inside out, holding his position, and bam! Hello. And Jimmy Green is no easy guy to put down.
No, we talked
about him earlier, partner, about him on one play,
yeah,
knocking out 2 starters on his own defense. Big time hit.
On the same play, which is just unbelievable.
Yeah, he went from one level to the next and left 2 bodies behind.
Third down and 15 now for Colorado State. Sperry is out to the right, number 80. Keep an eye on him.
And he rushed 4 on the play.
Allen looking for somebody. He's going to throw a deep incomplete intended for Luke Roberts, the sophomore out of Golden, Colorado.
Colorado State was that close to a huge play. Third and 15. Colorado elected to rush four and drop seven and had excellent coverage. But then in the scramble drill, the receiver got behind the defensive back. DB quit moving his feet. Receiver got behind. Ball just beyond the fingertips for the Colorado State Grands.
Taylor had a 51-yarder early in the first quarter. That's what Mike Hankwitz does, though. He'll mix up his coverage a lot in the secondary. There's a lot more diversity this year because guys understand what he's doing defensively. Here comes the fake. He's going to be dropped. The rush came right up the middle. Taylor had no place to go. And the first-year kicker is dumped by Lawrence Vickers. He's the one that got the penetration.
Lawrence Vickers shot the gap parts, and when he got there, that forced Kaler to pull it down. He couldn't punt it. And then the posse arrived for the Colorado State Buffaloes. See, Vickers, he forces it. Now here comes the stampede. Nowhere to go after that. They put Kaler down. The best field position of the day for Colorado. And they're going to try and get right back into this football game. Special teams telling the tale.
Once again, Kaler's a first-year kicker. He's just a sophomore.
He really had no chance
on
that one.
He didn't have any help.
Vickers shot the gap so fast, didn't matter what your timing was on trying to get rid of it.
A couple of tight ends now for Colorado, and they're going to keep it on the ground. Try on the right side. Not much going for Ellis. Jeff Horenick on the stop. Now the rest of our Orbitz keys for the Colorado Buffaloes.
Looking for the 2003 model for Joel Klatt. So far in this game, he's trying to manage it. First pass intercepted early. Players, not plays. In other words, get it to the playmakers. LaMelo make plays on offense and less conservative defense. Mike Hankwitz is going to mix things up. As you mentioned, Ron, many more options now available to him because they understand what he's trying to get done, and you'll see more pressure.
Back, look, goes towards the end zone. The pass is going to be incomplete, intended for his big tight end, Joe Klopfenstein.
And that's an example of a play call for a play. A player, not a play. Joel Klopfenstein is a big target at tight end. They wanted to try and get him the ball. Good coverage. As we look at the numbers from 2003, Joel Klatt, you see why they want that model. A 65% thrower, more yardage, 21 touchdowns, and only 10 interceptions. Almost the reverse in the interceptions last year. Tried to do so much and not aided by 39 drops from his receivers.
Sprague and Evan Judge wide to the left. Vickers in the backfield with Ellis. Klatt has some time. Over the middle, has a man open, overthrows him, incomplete. Intended for Klopfenstein again. Threw it, looked like behind him and a little high.
That's one he's going to want back, talking about Joel Klatt, because his offensive line protected. Watch. He's got protection. That's not a problem. He's able to step into it. Just high and behind. He has to hit Joel Klopfenstein in that situation. He got himself open. That's one he'll want back. Here comes nearly an automatic three from Mason Crosby.
Mason Crosby did not miss a field goal inside of 40 yards last year. The junior out of Georgetown, Texas, celebrating his 21st birthday. And he puts it up into the Chiefs seats. 11 for 11 last year inside the 40, 1 for 1 today. Ralphie the Buffalo. He's been on the field and he now has seen his team finally get on the board. Welcome back to Folsom Field in Boulder, Colorado. 12:22 left to play in the opening half. Colorado State struck first. And now Gary Barnett's squad adds 3 points, and that's why they trail 7-3. But what we've seen so far in this game, we talked about Colorado being diversified on offense. Colorado State also has been diversified on offense, which we're going to see here in a couple of seconds.
We've seen some of it already. We've seen four wides out of them. That's not normal. More two backs in the backfield. Usually have been a one back, three wide receiver team. They've made some changes in the offseason, as has Colorado.
Crosby's kick will be about 3 yards deep into the end zone. Herbert's going to bring it out. Crosses the 15, gets hit at the 18, still on his feet. Over the 25-yard line, up to about the 26-yard line. Now it's time for the Fan Rant, brought to you by Kia Motors.
Four.
thanks to the Opera Club up in Fort Collins, and they have something to sing about now. Another first down. Matt Bartz, the big tight end, the senior out of Concordia, Kansas, who blew out his knee in the USC game last year. They said this guy is so important to this offense.
And he's a guy that, as you mentioned, blew out his knee in the second or third game of the season last year against USC. Did not go through spring, did not go really through summer conditioning, and really showed up in the fall without having gone through all that. And he's out there playing with no brace and providing an extra dimension to their offense that we just saw. How about that leap for a guy coming back from ACL surgery?
Still trying to establish some type of running game. Kyle Bell has checked in, a sophomore out of Kingsburg, Colorado, Wells Central High School. He's a power guy, put out about 20 pounds since last year. He's like Anderson. We talk about David Anderson. We've seen him a couple of times on reception. But Kyle Bell's sort of the same way. You look at him in practice, you say, well, he's not that fast. He gets on the field, it's a different story.
Guy ran for over 8,000 yards in his high school career. The state of Colorado rushing champion. The record holder has added about 20 pounds since he's arrived on campus, become a much bigger thumper. But what a great job, and we'll get back to this in a minute, by the Colorado State defense holding Colorado after that turnover.
Looking for John Walker, gets him inside the 40-yard line to the 38-yard line. Pickup of about 3 on the play. That'll set up a third down and 3 situation. Walker, the sophomore out of Lancaster, California, he is what they call the playmaker. He had an incredible fourth down touchdown catch last year against Colorado. Just took it away from a couple of defenders. Big third down, though, for Colorado State. 3rd and 3.
And the reason I went back to that defensive stand for Colorado State, I think they gained momentum on offense by holding them to a field goal, and it looked like they might give up a sure 6. Now for the blitz.
Colorado showing it. Here they come. Holland takes 2 steps back, hits Anderson, good for the first down. Classic David Anderson. Let's check in with Ernie Johnson with a Tennessee update. He's in.
They were on the number 3 Vols, got a little battle on their hands today. They were up 17-3 over Alabama Birmingham when the Blazers get this Daryl Hackney to Reggie Lindsey scoring pass at 17-10. And look how close they came to tying this thing up late in the game, off the fingers of Lance Rhodes in the checkerboard end zone, and the Vols escape 17-10. You can breathe now, Charles.
Well, the sound you heard, Ernie, was Charles fainting up here. We are providing oxygen for him. Keeping it on the ground with Bell. Inside the 20-yard line to the 18-yard line. We always talk about rhythm. Offensive coordinators, Hammerschmidt, doesn't make any difference who it is. They talk about getting into that rhythm. Colorado State, after a shaky first series in the opening quarter, they've gotten into a rhythm now.
And now what's happened is they're getting ahead of the chains, meaning they're playing first and short. You know, after first down, it's 2nd and short. So they've got their playbook open to them. And the offensive line has really started to come together and chop holes in the defensive front for Colorado.
Now, that is a hot day out here. We have a player down, and it might be a cramp. Temperature's probably hovering around 90 degrees, unseasonably warm right now.
And we certainly hope that's what it is, but you see how he's lifting the toe?
Yeah.
Right there?
Looks like Brad Jones.
That's usually a sign.
Yeah, looks like Brad Jones, the redshirt freshman out of East Lansing, Michigan. We'll have an update on him in just a couple of seconds. First down and 10 for Colorado State, and they're moving. Just inside of 10 minutes left in the second quarter. Colorado State leading Colorado 7-3. Colorado has won the last 2 meetings between these 2 teams. And we look at Brad Jones. Now, Brian Iwu is already out of the ballgame. The senior linebacker out of Houston, he was injured. They've taken him to the locker room. His backup, Brad Jones, and now Jerry Barnett, he needs some linebackers. He's down to his 3rd team.
He's on his 3rd buff backer, outside linebacker, Ben Carpenter, number 19. Let's see if Dan Hammerschmidt has noticed. The guys up top have seen that and see if they want to test Ben Carpenter's area.
Jimmy Green looks for the block. It's free to running back Kyle Bell. Bell getting a little bit of work. Let's check in with Craig Sager. Sags.
Well, you know, Ron, most depth charts go too deep, but obviously with Ben Carpenter in there, they're down to their 3rd string outside linebacker. This is the first time he's gotten any snaps with the first unit. Brian Iwu tried to go back in there. He was circling around the huddle, but the training staff again will not clear him yet to go back in, and it is a cramp for Brad Jones.
And we'll keep an update on him from Des Moines, Iowa, right in the backyard of Iowa State in Iowa. Bell and Green now in the backfield. Second down and nine for the Rams. Hollins gets hit as he throws. Is it incomplete? Yes, it's incomplete. Caught and then dropped by Barks. He looked like he had it. It bobbled and he trapped it on the grass.
My theory on that one, terrific patience by Justin Hollins. See how he sets, waits for Barks to clear. And Barts was unable to get his head around and his feet set in enough time to truly pull the ball down. Terrific call by the official. Watch how he has it in his hands, but as he goes to the ground, doesn't have enough possession, and see how it hits? Great call by the official. That's not a catch.
Looked like he stopped his route right in the middle.
Yeah, if he got into the seam, and Holland was able to hit him, but he didn't get his head around quick enough to get set to catch it.
Third down and nine, three wide receivers to the right, two to the left. Holland, empty backfield. Four-man rush, this time, no, we've got a whistle and a penalty flag is thrown. This is something, listen to the call first.
Delay of game on the offense, 5-yard penalty, repeat third down.
That's their second delay of game for Sonny Luby's squad. This is something they worked on extensively, practice on Thursday, third and about seven, third and nine.
Be ready for these situations. Colorado fortunate on that play, and I'll tell you why. They had some confusion in the secondary on the coverage over Corey Sperry, number 80, Billingsley. Number five is in heavy discussions back there about who should have it. Him and Tyrone Henderson, number three. See if they're able to get organized on this snap.
Third down and 14. Holland looking to the right, looking over the middle. He's going to be hit from the backside. The ball is loose. Colorado State gets it back. It'll be a loss of about five on the play, and that'll bring up a fourth down. That is something that Colorado didn't do last year, and that's put pressure on Holland and make him move his feet.
You notice this year, Mike Hankwitz does not want to just totally sit back. And Abraham Wright, number 53 from the defensive end position. Upfield rush, came back when Holland stepped up in the pocket, forced the fumble. Nice pressure from the guys in black.
Evan Mark is going to attempt a field goal with a new holder this year in Joe Carney. They'll spot it at the 34-yard line. A 44-yard attempt, his first collegiate field goal. No. Looked like he may have hooked it just a little bit. He had the distance. He's got a strong leg. Just didn't have the accuracy on that one. Sonny Lubick wants to talk to him, but we'll take a timeout. 8:01 to play in the half. The score remains 7-3. Welcome back to Boulder, Colorado. You're watching TBS Saturday Night College Football presented by Orbitz. Here's some scores from around the country. And, of course, Ernie Johnson will update you on all the scores and highlights coming up at halftime, including the TCU upset of Oklahoma.
Yeah, that's the one that's going to get everyone's attention. Gary Patterson's done a great job at TCU, but they had an off year last year, and I don't think anyone expected them to go into Norman and shock the Sooners as they did today.
Colorado with 61 yards offense, 53 on their opening drive, which ended with an interception. Platt throws it out to the flat. Evan Judge on the reception, the senior out of Scottsdale, Arizona. Now, if you don't think it's tough being a kicker, take a look at this. This is what Kevin Mark had to go through. You miss the kick, you get bumped, and then you say, what, and then bang.
Terry Washington, number 10, with the first little nudge, and then Akarika Dawn celebrating going by and gave him a little love tap on the way off the field. Tough way for your first field goal attempt season.
He is one of the nice young men. We had a chance to spend a lot of time with Kevin. And what a personable young guy. He's going to have a nice little career here at Colorado State. Charles, left side, tries to get the first down. He about a half a yard short, it looks. Charles runs about a 4.37 40. This guy can motor when he gets to the corner. He's fast and strong despite his size of only 5'8", 185 pounds. We got another guy down, another player down. Now the story of this game is Gary Barnett's offense looked exceptional the first drive, but then the Colorado State defense stiffened, Charles.
And in a big way, Miles Kochaver with the first interception, then Robert Herbert with a nice tackle and a strip led to another one. And then how about Herbert there reading the play and smacking Evan Judge. Excuse me, Dusty Sprague on that one. Big time pop.
This Colorado State defense really struggled last year. In fact, so much that a lot of the players put up a sign in the locker room. It said 4-7, never again. All the kids on the defense and the offense, they're taking responsibility for each other. College football on TBS is brought to you by Honda, the company that defines performance in motorcycles, ATVs, personal watercraft, and scooters. And by The Man, starring Samuel L. Jackson and Eugene Levy, in theaters September 9th.
Didn't know you had a starring role in a movie. The Man.
The Man.
Got to talk about you.
The Old Man.
Got to talk about you. Third and short here, Ron. If you're Colorado, you sure would love to take the ball and jam it right up the middle and pick up a first down. A good, hard, physical play if you're Gary Barnett.
Vickers and Charles from the eye. Clatch is going to try to sneak it, and I'm telling you, they stacked that up pretty good.
Colorado State defensive front has become stouter as the game has gone on.
And they're not a big defensive line in any stretch of the imagination. That's going to be very close. You can see our Napa first and 10 line. Gary Barnett, let's see if he'll go for it. He went up for it 12 times last year on fourth down, and successful 33% of the time, but it's a moot point.
Just get down low and wedge in behind the big guys, and Joel Klatt does exactly that. We see the benefits of the added weight that Joel Klatt has put on. What does Sean Watson, his offensive coordinator and quarterbacks coach, tell us? When he first came, he was really a baseball player in terms of body type, but he's now become a football player. That's Sean Watson in the booth calling the plays for the Buffaloes.
Two tight ends for Colorado. Boffenstein moving around, and Klatt's going to put it up. He's a rush. Throws it into the flat, complete in Colorado State territory, the 47-yard line. Evan Judge on the reception. That is his second catch of the afternoon for the senior out of Scottsdale.
Great route by Evan Judge, because he got Darrell Williams, number 39, to turn, and he was running behind him. And he takes a shot there from Jesse Nading, number 59, and number 52, Courtney Jones from Colorado State. Some kind of hold his midsection a little going back to the huddle. But a great completion like that eases the pain.
Klatt had a little hitch there as after that play. Now Vickers and Charles will be in the backfield. Vickers is up. Charles, left side, breaks through. Here's the speed. Inside the 25, inside the 20, down to about the 15-yard line. Travis Garcia runs him out of bounds.
This is why you stay with the running game. Attrition. Eventually you hope something pops. On that play, Hugh Charles got to the linebackers, and Jeff Herenick, number 51, missed the tackle before Travis Garcia brings him down deep in the secondary. Big run for the Colorado Buffaloes and Hugh Charles.
31 yards on the scamper by Charles. First and 10, ball's now on the 15. Closing in on 6 minutes left here in quarter number two. Sprague in motion. Charles will try it again, hit the backfield. And he is going to be dropped back at the 23-yard line. Blake Smith, an outstanding sophomore out of Tulsa Union High School in Tulsa, Oklahoma. This is one of those motor kids everybody talks about. Delroy Park also in on that, but Blake Smith got the penetration. This kid is going to be a dandy.
Yeah, he's lost some weight because he's had back problems in the past, and they thought if he lost weight, it would relieve some of the pressure. He's had a pretty good summer camp, back from a bad back last year. And on that play, one of the notes I have, very quick off the ball. We just saw that, didn't we?
Very much so. We've got a timeout with 6:11 to play in the half. Joel Klatt trying to get his Buffs with a 7-pointer instead of just a field goal. Are they starting to feel the rhythm again, Charles, offensively? We're going to find out. 6:11 to play. We'll be back. This telecast is a copyrighted presentation of the University of Colorado, a member of the Big 12 Conference. It may not be reproduced or retransmitted in any form, and the accounts and descriptions of this game may not be disseminated without the express written consent of the University of Colorado or the Big 12 Conference. Don't worry, that TBS is biodegradable. We'll have it off by the end of the game. Kloffenstein, Joe Kloffenstein, the big tight end of Colorado, does not have a reception yet in this game. Is this the time to go to him again?
Well, if they get into a spread situation, looks like Colorado's coming out what they call a solo set. Two tight ends. There's Kloffenstein, 89. He and Sipnuski, 45. Two wide receivers, one running back in the backfield. It's a balanced set, which makes it tough for the defense because they're not tipping their hand going strong side or weak side. Now they've got him on the move.
Vickers alone in the backfield. Colorado State with seven on the line of scrimmage. They bring five. That little timing pattern caught inside the five down to the 4-yard line. And guess who it is? Joe Kloffenstein, the big tight end.
Terrific play call by Sean Watson, the offensive coordinator, because what he did was isolate Joel Kloffenstein, a Miles Cochaver, the strong safety. The height and strength and in weight advantage all goes to Kloffenstein, and he's able to muscle pass Cochaver and get inside, and Klatt delivers.
Leading return man as far as reception. Five touchdown receptions last year. Vickers and Charles now in the backfield. Charles, right side, hit hard by Robert Herbert, who's having a good game. Four tackles already in the half for the junior. He leads the team.
I know one thing here. Gary Barnett, Sean Watson, the offensive coordinator, Dave Warberly, the offensive line coach for Colorado, they will not butt their heads against a brick wall.
Right.
But I know that in their heart of hearts, they want to be so strong and tough down here. They want to line up. They've had three tight ends in on the last play. They're going three tight ends again. And they want to take that ball and jam it inside against Colorado State and feel better about themselves.
Klatt dumps it off to Vickers down to the 3-yard line. They'll mark it. That'll be a third down and goal. Here's Craig Seger.
Well, following up what Charles said, the two tight ends there helping out the blocking because Colorado's offense on the sidelines now, two starters. Tyler Palumbas is being treated for a shoulder injury, and Brian Daniels with a back injury. So Daniel Sanders and Gary Moore, two backups now on that front line.
Great observation, Craig, because now you've got to go to a different set to get the kind of strength you want. And now they've got three tight ends. Paul Creighton, number 30, has been on the field with Sipnuski, 45, and Kloffenstein, 89. Let's see if they try and jam it in again with Vickers, 17, as the lead back.
Charles dancing, ducks his head, fights forward, may have gotten down to the 1-yard line. That'll bring up a fourth down and goal.
This time I say go.
Why not?
Because if you're Gary Barnett, one of the things he told us in our meeting, sometimes you have to tell your team how much you like them in order to have confidence. Sonny Lubick did it in the first quarter. It paid off. I think Gary Barnett's going to do the same thing here.
And that's exactly what they're going to do. Inside of 4 minutes left in the first half.
How about this challenge for both sides? Can Colorado State dig in, and will Colorado come right at it?
Schaub's the fullback. Vickers is behind him. Vickers puts his head down. Touchdown, Colorado. Vickers, who had a couple of rushing touchdowns last year, the most versatile back on this team, hence the V-back name tag. There was no denying him. Crosby with the extra point. Right straight through the uprights. Only missed two last year. The touchdown, the extra point, 73 yards capped by this run.
And I think Colorado got exactly what they want. Look at the end of the play. You see Vickers with the forearm slamming Robert Herbert down. That's exactly what Colorado wanted. Obviously the touchdown, but in the most physical way possible. Both teams trying to establish dominance. Colorado feels as if they have the upper hand right now.
How about the block that Brendan Shaw put on Miles Kochaver? They buried him into the turf.
We had three tight ends and two fullbacks. Shaw just got a scholarship here this fall because of his great play on special teams and as a blocking back. Great block on Kochaver, and then Vickers, with his strength, finishes it off.
Well, that puts Colorado back on top at 10-7 with 3:36 left to play in the opening half. Impressive drive for a number of reasons. Number one, they went for it on fourth down. Number two, they showed a little versatility running the football, alternating both Ellis and Charles, and then Vickers coming in to finish things off.
Almost a little bit of payback for Lawrence Vickers. Remember, he forced the punt.
That's right.
Two series ago. They only got a field goal out of that one. This time they come back. He gets the payoff on the touchdown.
Rousey's kick will go about a yard deep. Herbert up over the 30-yard line. As for Colorado State will begin, let's check in with Ernie Johnson in our studio.
All right, thank you, Ron. You never know what might happen on this first weekend of the college football season. We'll show you an example of that on the Chili's Halftime Report with the highlights of Oklahoma and TCU. And we've got a sneak peek at Nebraska. You're going to see him next week on TBS. Bill Callahan wearing the mic for some Cornhusker access. That's coming up at halftime. Back to you, Ron.
Thanks, Ernie. Of course, we'll have Nebraska Wake Forest next Saturday night right here on TBS. Get our first look at the Cornhuskers. Right now, the business at hand is Colorado, Colorado State. Allen has plenty of time to work with. There's that rifle of an arm. Gets over the 45-yard line. Up to the 48-yard line, David Anderson. How does this guy get open? I mean, you look at the speed, it's not that great, but he always seems to find space.
Terrific route runner and creates separation. See how he gets the stick, moves inside, and has his body between the ball and the defender. He's a very smart player, watches a lot of film, understands defenses. And I said earlier in the game he didn't have a catch. He caught one for no yardage. I'm not used to that, out of David Anderson. And now his catches are starting to pile up.
He's a gym rat, that's for sure. First down and 10 for Colorado State. Oh, a little wobbly on the ball, but Anderson still comes down with it. He's not afraid to take the hit. And if you notice, you look at the tape that we've looked at over the last couple of days and today, he takes the hit, what's he do? Boom, bounces right back up again. Well, our first and 10 line this afternoon is brought to you by NAPA. Right now, that first and 10 line is only about 3 yards away from the line of scrimmage line. There it is, the yellow line. Second and three, 2.5 to play in the opening half. Got to keep it on the ground. Kyle Bell getting a little action today. That's good enough for a first down. Washington with his fourth tackle of the afternoon.
They were wanting to establish a feature back. Talk about Colorado State. Nnamdi O'Harry got the first set of carries in the ball game.
Mm-hmm.
A number of carries. He limped off the field earlier in this game. Kyle Bell's now stepped in, and many people thought he would get the feature back job anyway. Here's his opportunity. And we know Sonny Lubick likes the running game. See the number of 100-yard running backs he's had? A whole bunch of them in his time in Fort Collins.
Curry now goes into the backfield. Adds a little protection. A little wobbly ball. Holland is being hit right as he was releasing the ball. Looked like Billingsley was coming in on a safety blitz. He's got to shake that right arm off a little bit.
Well, if you're Kyle Bell, running the ball is terrific. But to stay on the field, you have to pass block. Watch Bell here, number 34. You've got to protect your quarterback. Billingsley on the blitz coming at him. Circled the wrong guy. My bad on that one. But when Bell slid over, didn't get enough of the defender, and he was able to make a play on the quarterback and force the incompletion.
Second down and 10. Colorado brings four. Allen has time. That long out pattern is caught inside the 40 to the 37-yard line. Sims puts the hit on David Anderson.
I love David Anderson.
Oh, I'm telling you what, this young man is exceptional. There's going to be a timeout called. It'll be called Colorado State. Great neighborhood he grew up with. I mean, he was telling us about the neighborhood back out in Westlake Village, California. Yeah, it was kind of like a who's who when it came to throwing the ball around, and when they were very, very young.
Yeah, Ben Olsen, who's now at UCLA, and has a chance to be the quarterback there, back from a Mormon mission for 2 years. He was David Anderson's quarterback in high school, which makes it all the more surprising that there wasn't more attention for David Anderson. I think more people upgraded Ben Olsen and downgraded the receiving core, and they missed on this young man.
Check out what's on TBS Sunday night.
Sunday night on TBS. Jackie Chan.
Do you understand the words that are coming out of my mouth?
Chris Tucker.
Don't nobody understand the words that are coming out of your mouth, man.
Rush Hour 2, Sunday night at 8 on TBS.
That'll be coming up on Sunday. But for Saturday afternoon, it's Colorado, Colorado State. And when you look at David Anderson, too, this is a young man that works extremely hard. He's articulate. He's a broadcast major, which means he wants one of our jobs in the next few years.
I think he wants both.
I think he does.
He thinks that he can go ahead and do both of our jobs in one fell swoop. And he's a team leader, not necessarily because he's always in guys' faces and grabbing face masks, but he knows how to keep a team loose. But the way he practices forces you to get better, because if your better players are leaders on the practice field, no one else has any excuses for slacking.
And for his dad, he did want us to make sure we said hi. I know you're overseas, and
he's in Guam.
He's in Guam. He said to say hi to my dad. George Hill, Anderson. Split out. A lot of noise. They get it to him. Bounces off one tackle, splits the seam. He's got daylight. 10, 5. No, they're going to mark him out at the 3. One of the things that they wanted Justin Holland to have this year is patience. He had the patience, but he got the ball where it needed to be.
Tom Hubbard, number 9 in Colorado, has the chance. Unable to break down and throttle himself down to make the tackle. He came through like a missile, left his feet, and George Hill shook him, and now he's out at the 3-yard line.
Ooh, I don't know about that. That foot looked like there was some green between it and the sideline. Can't tell there. Colorado trying to get players on the field. Didn't have enough. First and goal from the 3.
A lot of confusion for the Colorado Buffalo defense.
They're going to have to call a timeout.
12 guys on the field. They had one guy too many. Fortunately, they got the timeout and not the penalty.
Mike Hankwitz wants to talk to his troops about that. Let's take a look at that again from the one angle. See what we can see. Once again, there is replay. Unless it's his heel, huh?
Yeah, and the trail official was on the play. You just notice him in the background there, looking down at the feet. We had a front view. He had the back view. Let's take a look. If you talk about the heel, right there on the side, no.
Well, that's
close, and that could be some white there.
Yeah, they spotted the 3.
Remember, he's the trail official looking at it, and is Ron Target. I'm not going to question what he saw on that one. That was close enough. I'd give him definitely the benefit of the doubt on that call.
Bottom line, it was not only a nice quick throw again by Holland, but Hill did a great job just splitting and following his blocks, and the wide receivers did an outstanding job blocking on that play. Once again, instant replay in the Big 12. You can replay official, alternate game official, and technician are about 4 or 5 booths down from us, and they're going to be buzzed when a play is under review. And the replay official will determine if there is indisputable video evidence to overturn.
I think that's the key on that play. I don't think there would be indisputable video evidence to overturn the call.
There's the booth. We promise you they are there. we do. It's not an empty booth that we just picked. There is somebody in there.
You know someone's important when you know the windows are darkened that much.
That's
you can't see in. You know you're big.
Minute and 36 to play in the half. Colorado has a 3-point lead. Colorado first and goal from the 3. Green and Walker now in the backfield. 2 bruisers. Green. Banging his way down to the 1-yard line. Tyrone Henderson making the first hit. A junior out of Oakland, California, his second tackle of the afternoon.
As important as I said that it was for Colorado to score with a tough inside run, I think Colorado State's thinking the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
They've gone with a robust backfield, 2 fullbacks essentially,
Tristan Walker, Jimmy Green on the field. They have a big, heavy lineup in. Let's see if they try and run Jimmy Green inside again.
Games of last year. Nope, stopped again. You think they're having some nightmares from 2004. Thaddeus Washington on the stop of Green. But they do have some timeouts to work with 45 seconds to go.
Thad Washington, number 49, inside out on the play as Green cuts inside. That first hit was 49 Washington, then dies on 44, trying to help out also. Great positioning by the linebacker. Inside, didn't allow the cutback. Great wrap-up form tackle and puts him down.
Now 43 seconds to play. Each team out with one timeout remaining. Sonny Lubick just letting his offensive coordinator, Dan Hammerschmidt, talk it over with Holland. Stick around, by the way, for the Chili's halftime report. Ernie Johnson will catch you up on all of today's action, including the big upset with TCU over Oklahoma. Nebraska Cornhuskers will be there next week. We'll show you what Bill Callahan's doing in Lincoln, plus scores and highlights from around college football, including Tennessee fighting off Watson Brown's UAB squad.
If I knew that would be a battle.
You did not.
Oh, yeah, knew it would be a battle.
You know, we talk about conference titles. Everybody says, hey, it's Oklahoma, it's Kansas State. But when you look at it, Colorado, K-State, Nebraska, and Texas all with three in the Big 12.
Yeah, Colorado, K-State, Nebraska all in the Big 12 North, Oklahoma and Texas in the South. Let's see what they line up with here. Because if they come back with that robust lineup, I don't expect them to toss the ball. I expect them to come at him and come hard. But Sperry, number 80, is the H-back. See if he's on the move.
Two tight ends. Green in the backfield. Holland keeps it. Looking for Anderson in the corner. Still looking. Throws. Touchdown, Colorado State. David Anderson. Officially a one-yard touchdown reception by David Anderson. He's had 129 receptions over the last 2 years for this Colorado State team. That was classic David Anderson, just getting open. The extra point. It is good by Kevin Mark.
Great patience by Justin Holland. Approached the line of scrimmage, waits, waits, waits. And David Anderson, who was covered initially by Lorenzo Sims, number 22, watch. Sims is over there, right? Now he's coming. And he just lets him bypass him and cuts back inside. Patience by Holland, the quarterback, threatening the line of scrimmage and then backing off to create a little extra time for the play. And Anderson, never giving up on it, rolling back inside to complete the touchdown.
I thought Colorado kids were supposed to be calm and cool. He's pretty excited over there, huh?
You know, when it's Colorado State in Colorado, you can take your calm and cool and put it to the side for a while.
Yeah, that's exactly right. I'll be cool tomorrow. I got Labor Day to be cool. David Anderson with his first touchdown reception of the year. We've told you at the top of the show about the physical play that both teams wanted. We've seen that so far. Teams going on fourth down. And we also told you about fireworks, offensive fireworks, and we're seeing that here in this opening half. Colorado State already 181 yards in offense, 134 for Colorado. Pretty much what we thought, huh?
Yeah, and what's been interesting for me is that both teams have tried to establish their presence, their physicality, and neither one has backed down.
How about a little squib kick? Fumbled into the end zone. And that's a smart thing to do, just take the knee. Well, we told you about David Anderson being excited. His first year at Colorado State, he figured out this was a pretty big game.
Coming from California at first, I didn't really know much about it. I'm going to be honest. I was always a USC, UCLA guy, Stanford, Cal guy. And so I was like, CSU, CU, it can't be that big. I didn't really understand it. And then I went to the first game in Invesco. My freshman year, I didn't even get to play, really. I just sat on the sidelines. But I never had that much blood pumping through me. My nerves were going all over the place. And I saw Cecil Sapp run through five defenders, jump in the end zone. And, like, it was perfectly split. And our half of the stand just went crazy. And I was like, well, I got to get involved in this.
And he is involved. Now, last year, he didn't have his first reception until about 3 minutes left in quarter number two. And the coaches were emphatic to us on Thursday at Fort Collins, saying, we've got to get him involved in this offense right away.
Anderson with seven receptions already, and he likes Justin Holland. You can see before Justin Holland's injury and then after, he and Holland have kind of a connection going on.
They do, and I think a lot of it has to do with Justin Holland's big arm. And then Caleb Haney, who came in as a true freshman last year, it's tough enough to find your way to the library as a true freshman,
yeah.
Let alone go out and play football in the Mountain West Conference in the type of offense that Sonny Lubick wants to run. He did a good job, but it's hard to establish those connections that you've had with other guys previously.
Library? What's that?
Oh, yeah, I forgot about us.
Okay, yeah.
But, you know, I'm trying to present a new image for
there
us.
Okay? Thank you. I appreciate
because
it.
Because both of these teams have excellent students on them. I don't want us to become overrun by them.
There you go. Charles and Vickers now in the backfield.
See if they run some type of a screen here to create some space.
And it is for Charles. They wanted to get him the ball. 29 seconds left. He's run out. One thing we haven't seen, we've seen a couple of times, I guess I should say, that Colorado has put pressure defensively, but they really haven't gotten to Holland except for the one time they stripped the ball, if I'm not mistaken.
And I think part of that goes back to the injury to Brian Ewell.
Yeah, exactly.
He's one of their better blitzers. And with him not in the lineup, I think Mike Hankwitz is thinking about his second line guys, thinking about Brad Jones, and also thinking about, Carpenter, Ben Carpenter, maybe not wanting to utilize them in the same way to try and get pressure on the quarterback.
Patrick Williams, the redshirt freshman, far to the left. They go over the middle. Pass is complete over the 35 to Kloffenstein. They mark it at about the 38-yard line. It'll be first down. Stop the clock with 23 to go. We got another player down.
And that's Jamal Hall, number two, who is an undersized linebacker. And if you talk to anyone around the program, they love his motor. They love the way that he'll hit and hustle. But because he's undersized, he gets dinged up a lot.
Hasn't played a whole season yet.
And the problem is he's putting a hit on Joel Kloffenstein, who's 6'6", 245. Jamal Hall weighs 193, and then he takes an extra shot from his own guy. Looks like Hrenek. Jeff Hrenek, number 51, the eager redshirt freshman. And that's the second time Hall's been hurt by one of his own players this fall. First it was Jimmy Green in a scrimmage, and now it's Hrenek coming in and getting the second tag on. So he puts the hit right there, and then Hrenek, see the helmets going into each other? Let's hope Jamal Hall is okay and able to return later today.
Well, he's limping off the field.
Good sign he's coming off on his own power. He'll get the halftime now to get himself back together.
23 seconds left. Colorado has one timeout remaining now. They don't need to get too much farther to be in field goal range for Crosby. Pat steps up, lost the ball, got it back. The left hand came out and surrounded it. Clock goes down to 9 seconds, 8 seconds. Gary Barnett's probably saying, let's just get to the locker room and talk about this.
And Jesse Nading with the big time pressure from the backside. He's a young man who's grown up a lot in just a single year. A terrific football player.
Now they didn't even give Mason Crosby a chance to try another 60-yarder, which he had last year. Here's Craig Seger with Sonny Lubick.
Well, Sonny, you've been waiting a lot of months to see Justin Holland and Mark Anderson team up again. Talk about that go-ahead touchdown.
That was a great play by Justin. The fact he just kept himself alive, bought time, and then they had a whole team over there, and David found an open place. That was a great throw, great catch.
A key play in the game, according to Charles Davis, was when you had that ball, 4th and 2 at your 7. You decided to go for it. Were you trying to give confidence to your team?
That's what I wanted to do. Let's see if we can go get 7. We needed 7 points and not settle for the 3. That lucky call.
Good call. Score right now, 14-10. Let's go back upstairs to Rod.
It was a good call, Coach, not a lucky call. That ends the first half of TBS Saturday Night College Football, presented by Orbitz. We'll join Ernie Johnson in our studios right after this break. The Rocky Mountain Showdown is exactly what we thought it would be. At halftime, Colorado State leading in-state rival Colorado at halftime. Hello, Charles Davis. I'm Ron Thula. And you look at the stats, throw them out the window. Bottom line is Colorado's turned the ball over twice, and Colorado State's taken advantage of both of them.
Yeah, and really, the last drive before the half for Colorado State was huge because Colorado had just stuck it in the end zone with emphasis on them, and Colorado State came right back. If it's a boxing analogy, they're both still in the center of the ring. No one's been backed up yet. Let's see how the second half progresses.
Now let's take a look at some of the numbers from that opening half. And I think what stands out, if you're Sonny Lubick, you love the balance.
And that's exactly what he sought going into this ball game. And so far in the first half,
19 runs, 19 passes for the Colorado State Rams. Can't get any more balanced than that, Ron.
Not balance in yards, but balance in plays, and that's exactly what he wanted. And you can see the turnovers, 2-0, and Colorado State leading in total yards. Now, Colorado, obviously, they won the toss. They defer to the second half, so they'll get the ball first in this second or third quarter. How important is it for them to come out and try to establish something and start to dominate at least one of the lines of scrimmage?
Well, I think Gary Barnett told his team at the half, after we scored, Colorado State did not back down. They came right back at us. It's our turn now. We need to come right back at them.
Let's check in with Craig Sager. Craig.
Well, Gary Barnett obviously was not happy with the turnovers, but he said also the pass that Joel Klatt threw in the end zone that overthrew the wide open receiver is something that's been very uncharacteristic of Joel Klatt. He thinks as a veteran he will bounce back. When they get the ball in offense, he says, I want a quick scores. I want to move the ball out. We're waiting too long. We're being too patient. We want to catch them off guard. I also asked how come David Anderson got open on that play. He goes, we had him shadowed perfectly, but our guys were just too fast and they outran him.
You know, Craig, that's exactly what he told all of us, is that they wanted to dictate the tempo. They wanted an NFL tempo, and they really didn't have that in the first half.
Yeah, outside of the first two series of the game. And they turned it over.
Well, Dustin Sprague can't put the meat hooks on it off his hands. 39 drop balls last year for this Colorado offense. Klatt had 7 of them in the spring game. They got to start putting their hands on the football and holding on. So far, the leaderboard, Klatt, 89 yards. Charles, 30 yards rushing. Klopfenstein, only 2 receptions. And he was wide open on one. That would have been a touchdown.
Yeah, that's the one Craig Sager referenced, because that would have been an easy 7 points. Uncharacteristically, Joel Klatt missed him on that one. It's bounce back time for Joel Klatt here in the second half.
On 2nd and 10. Charles spins away up over the 25-yard line. Miles Cochaver on the stop. That is his first tackle. He had the interception that put a halt to a very impressive Colorado opening drive.
He got more out of that play than he should have.
Mm-hmm.
It was an old Washington Redskins counter tray, brought 2 linemen around. He had great vision on the play, though, because if he had gone where the play was designed, he would have been met by a lot of guys in white shirts. So he used his eyes and cut back to the other side and gained positive yardage. The Colorado offensive line, after each play here in the second half, a couple guys have been slow getting back to the huddle.
On 3rd down, into the flat. Close to a 1st down, give it to him. Nice timing pattern. Charles showing that he also can catch the ball. They emphasize passing in the spring game. This is why.
Wide receiver screen is essentially the play, although they put the running back in that slot, and he broke through the tackle that would have kept him from the 1st down. Great job. It ends up becoming a running play.
Yeah.
In lateral because of where the ball was thrown.
Well, it's a 1st down for Colorado. All right on the 31-yard line. Looking for a block. Gets it up over the 40-yard line. Ball is loose, and Colorado State will have it. Nope, they're saying he was down. Courtney Jones is right in on things, along with Darrell Williams for Colorado State. That was close.
That play was close to breaking bigger because he kind of had to gather himself off of the pitch. You notice how he had to stop himself a little on the pitch, but once he got it, good block by number 4, Patrick Williams, out on the corner, the redshirt freshman. He was down.
Yes.
As he hit the ground, that's when the ball came out.
Flat looks right, throws left, pass is complete to Evan Judge. Penalty flag is thrown as he gets inside the 40, down to the 38-yard line. Coach Aver on the coverage.
Darrell Williams out on the corner, missing a tackle in open field, allowed the receiver to get downfield with yards after the catch.
It's going to go against Colorado.
Pass interference, number 82 on the offense. 15-yard penalty, repeat 1st down.
Well, now we know how Evan Judge got so open. There's one, he missed on the 1st one.
Come on, he's persistent, that's got to be some
points. Missed on the 1st one and he got the 2nd one out there. And the reason he got called for it, arm extended.
Yeah.
He's noticed how he was out wide open. All of us could see it as he extended the arm. It wasn't much of a push, But once you're out there that far, the official has no choice but to throw
He's got to toss that ankle down. That's the third penalty for Gary Barnett's squad. Had a couple of that opening half that were costly, pushed him back. You will see Colorado State already with five.
Yeah, a little uncharacteristic. You mentioned that in the first half. They averaged four penalties per game last year against Colorado State. Colorado averaged eight penalties per game last year.
Well, we put it up again. The deep out, incomplete, intended for the redshirt freshman Patrick Williams. You know, they've done a lot of creativity with the staff at Colorado. In college football, you usually have a system-oriented type team. Now they have an exceptional situation as far as the staff. A little different.
Yeah, what they want are play-oriented system, meaning they've got guys that they know can do certain things. Mm-hmm. One guy's fast. One guy's shifty. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
One guy can run inside well. One guy can run outside well. They want to call plays to their strengths, guys who can make big plays and get them to them. And they even take guys and move them out of their natural position into spots where they can make those big plays.
Second down in the bunch, it's at 25. Flat looking to set up the screen, and they do to Charles. Looks for one block, gets it. Needs another, gets it. Has some running room. Inside the 50, down to the 47-yard line. He got the blocks he needed. Garcia and Cochaver coming up to make the stop. But Jack Tipton also was one of the big linemen who allowed Charles to get open.
Second time we've seen this screen pass today. The first time we saw it in the first half to Lawrence Vickers. He scored a touchdown but was called back due to a hold. This time they use Hugh Charles on the play. 27-yard gain. But you don't get downfield unless your wide receivers block. Look at this. There's one. There's two. Both engaged. That allowed the lineman to get downfield and help him rumble.
And that sets up a first down. Oh, hello, Mr. Jamal Hall. That'll have to check your dentures after that one.
So a lot of guys call it chin checkup.
That is a chin checkup.
We're going to check your chin on that one. Jamal Hall, number two, says, I'm wearing half of the number you're wearing, Byron Ellis, but bringing all the load with me. Look at that.
How did he hold on to the football? Lost two on the play.
Yeah, it's good to see Jamal Hall back right before the end of the first half. That young man, you know, this is an overused phrase, a guy with a nonstop motor. But Jamal Hall's just ticks on high, doesn't it?
He just has the pedal down the entire way. Now the play clock was at four, so that's not a problem. It's going to be movement on Colorado. So they'll pick up their fourth penalty. You can't keep shooting yourself in the foot when you
prior
start getting some momentum.
False start, 77 on the offense. 5-yard penalty, repeat second down.
Columbus is the culprit. Our first and 10 line is brought to you by NEPA. Once again, the first and 10 line is yellow, line of scrimmage is red. That'll bring up a second down and 17. Just about 3.5 gone by here in quarter number three. Judge and Patrick Williams wide to the left. Now Judge goes in the slot. Ellis in motion. Penalty flag is thrown. Pass is complete to Kloppenstein. He gets inside the 40 down to the 37. That's going to be a hold in the backfield. And again, it'll be against Colorado. Let's check in quickly with Craig Seger.
Well, obviously the Colorado sideline's not happy with that call, but a little bit of spark and excitement because Brian Iwo has come out of the locker room and has joined the team, and he has been cleared to play in the second half when they do get the ball. Couple number observations. We had two number fives out there for the Colorado offense. So Alvin Barrett
Boulder,
is wearing number eight.
73 on the offense. 10-yard penalty from the line of scrimmage. Still second down.
Thanks, Craig, for that update because we noticed him out there and we're like, now who is that?
I know. And you know what's funny? We've been just lobbying for the last 4 years. Stop the duplicate numbers.
You have numbers that can go from double zero through 99. Okay? Yeah, NCAA. How many times do we have to go over this? We get missed calls all the time. Guys with a number, they can't play because duplicate numbers.
Well,
please.
Joe Klatt's going to call a timeout with second and 27. Wants to talk about it with his coaches on the far side. He's talking to Vickers about it. I think the manager is taking control of the situation over there. We're going to take a break. 11:09 left in quarter number three. Colorado State led at halftime, and they're still on top. The It is hot in Boulder, Colorado. Temperature in the low 90s right about now. Everybody's putting on the fans. Uncharacteristically hot today, but it's a dry heat, so that's not too bad. It's still hot.
It's 115, but yeah. It's a dry heat.
It's still hot. I love Charles Barkley. It's still hot. Don't give me that.
I agree with him totally.
Now Colorado facing a second and 27 with 11:09 left in quarter number three. Had a couple of penalties here in the third. Cause this drive to stall a little bit. Sprague goes wide to the right. Flat, looking, throwing, firing, passes complete. Quinn Sepnewski, the tight end, his second reception, the senior out of Granger, Iowa. This guy's been plagued by injuries. This is his third senior year, I guess is the best way to put it, because of injuries.
Does that mean he's going to go through three senior ceremonies?
I think he should.
Parents get on the field three times. Here's the possessions for the game for Colorado, their first six. Interception, halftime, punt, field goal, touchdown, half.
Yeah.
The touchdown was a run by Lawrence Vickers. The field goal came after the punt attempt by Colorado State was snuffed. They were unable to punch it in.
Here comes the blitz. They pick it up. Flat back pedals, throws it at the feet, which is probably a pretty good thing because Vickers was surrounded. Flat takes a seat. Jamal Hall was there to break things up. Garcia was putting pressure. Watches pressure.
And this is the third time they've tried to go to the screen. And what's happened for Colorado, unfortunately, is they have essentially wasted two big plays with this screen pass. First half, it was called back on a hold when Vickers scored. The second time, they got a great play with Ellis, and then, with Hugh Charles, and then later on, they got a penalty and wasted all the yardage they gained. And here, Colorado State was waiting for it.
Well, Torp was able to hang 22 punts last year inside the 20. He's had one today, which is career-long, 72 yards. It's fourth down and five, and he's going to have to hang it up again. And we're going to get another timeout. Well, delay of game. Well, here's why they had the delay of game. He needs some yards to work with here. This guy's going to kick it somewhere, I think, down to downtown Denver.
He's going to try and bang it inside the 20. And last year, because of their kick game, 50% of the possessions for their opponents, for Colorado's opponents, started at the 20-yard line or less. And if you took away turnovers, it's 53% of the time. So you talked about the weapons their kickers are. Graphic example right there.
And now it's pressure on the defense to step up. Corp gets it high. It's wobbly. Fair catch is being called for at the 18-yard line. 28 yards on the kick, but that's going to be deceiving. Well, it's time now for Tough in the Trenches, brought to you by Yamaha ATVs.
Both teams wanted to be better at stopping the run coming into this season, and Colorado early in the ball game made it very difficult for Colorado State to find room to run. The Colorado Buffaloes tough in the trenches.
Only allowed 33 yards so far on the ground for Colorado State. Holland throwing it up deep down the middle. Looking for Walker. Penalty flag is thrown. That's going to be interference. Tyrone Henderson got the hand on there. He was turned around. Walker was trying to get position. Vakamanapuna put a hit on Justin Holland right after he released
it. Pass interference. Number three in the defense. 15-yard penalty. First down.
Okay. From experience, here's what happened. Tyrone Henderson was playing the man, didn't know where the ball was, and when John Walker tried to wrap back inside, by the time Tyrone Henderson turned his head to locate the ball, it was too late. There was contact. The defensive back will lose that battle every time if the offensive player initiates contact when his head is facing the receiver, because the officials won't give you that call as a defensive back because they think the receiver's making a play on the ball. Good move by Walker to wrap back inside and force Anderson's hand.
Anderson goes in motion. First and 10, ball's on the 34. Kyle Bell. Once again, Nnamdi O'Harry was injured in that first half. Bell getting the call, getting the yeoman's work as far as running the football. Rushed for just a shade under 96 yards last year. Averaged 3.7 a carry. Even took some yoga this year to
help a little bit with the balance.
Trying to help the balance and the flexibility. And how fitting was it that we just did the tough in the trenches, and Colorado showed it again on that play. James Garrett, number 82, a converted defensive end, moved inside the tackle. He led the charge on the last play.
On second and 11, and again, they're tough in the trenches. They're doing a nice job of stringing it out just enough where all these black shirts can surround the running back. Akamanapuna comes up with the tackle. That's his second. He was joined by Thaddeus Washington.
Watching here, the trench guys, when they move inside, those trench guys, when they're going, they're holding the point of attack so no one can really gash them. Mm-hmm. And then that allows the linebackers to run free behind them and fill in whatever holes there are. Manapuna that time came from inside in his tackle position to make a nice play.
That's exactly the way Mike Hankovich draws it up for Colorado. On third and eight, Holland rifles the ball. Caught. Guess who? David Anderson again, his eighth reception of the game.
If you're a secondary coach, a defensive coordinator, your frustration kicks in when this guy keeps making plays. You know why? He's not a secret.
That's
right. It's not like we didn't know that David Anderson was a great receiver. If you're ever going to err in coverage, err towards the guy who's all-conference potential All-American and make sure you know where he is. He had their heads turned again for big yardage.
Pick up a 21 on the play. Jimmy Green dancing around in the backfield. Straight ahead running with Kyle Bell. Trips up over the 40, down to the 38-yard line. Brian Iwu back in the ballgame, made the stop. That's his third tackle of the game. But you look at Anderson, Pete Rebstock was a pretty doggone good receiver. He reminds a lot of people up at Fort Collins of Pete Rebstock.
Yeah, especially because of the number. Mm-hmm. You know, they both wore four. They're the same type of receiver. Tough, gritty, always find a way to get open. It's 11th career, six reception game. Eight catches thus far today.
Well, Colorado now with two backup linebackers, Akarika Don and Marcus Burton in there to join Ewers. And they keep it on the ground. Bell just lowering the shoulder on Tyrone Henderson. I tell you, this young man, he is 6'2", 210, but he is strong and he can run.
That yoga's some tough stuff. I gotta tell you. He and Jimmy Green.
That's right.
Three times a week offseason with the yoga. And these guys are running. There's not much om and meditation in their run. All right?
No, not hardly.
They must have taken the explosive yoga class.
Yeah. Advanced yoga.
I didn't know they had a violent yoga class, because these guys, they initiate some collisions when they run the football.
Billy Blank's yoga. Holland, little play action. Throws it into the flat to John Walker. Trips and falls, and he gets to the 27-yard line. Lorenzo Sims was on the coverage. Walker, who was a high school option quarterback, is really the big-time playmaker here. When you want something, you talk David Anderson, playmaker, but the big one is John Walker.
They say that he's had a tremendous fall camp, kind of been the surprise of the camp. He's starting to really come along and develop, becoming a better receiver in terms of all of his routes, not just the routes that get him deep downfield and stretch the defense.
He has three receptions, second down and eight. Three wide receivers to the left.
Haven't heard from Corey Sperry in a while.
Speaking of, Sperry's got it. Ducks his head, gets down to the 22-yard line. You called it. Jared Burrell on the stop, and he's going to have a headache after that one.
I'm not an offensive coordinator, but I'm trying to play one on TV. And I think the tough part, if you're Dan Hammerschmidt, the offensive coordinator for Colorado State, is to resist the temptation to try and call a play every time for Corey Sperry. Trying to pick your spots. Get him balls, get him in open field, and let him use his size and speed to matriculate the ball downfield.
That's too big for me.
God rest Hank Stramsel.
There you go. Jimmy Green and Tristan Walker in the backfield on 33. Green, straight ahead. Crosses the Napa first down line, gets inside the 20, down to the about the 17.
I know one thing I'm doing, Parts. I'm enrolling you and I in a yoga class.
I'm telling you, I thought my Pilates was good.
Look at Jimmy Green, right at you. But look at the guys up front, carving a hole. He runs through Thad Washington's attempted tackle. And Tom Hubbard has quite a time trying to get him down. Needs a lot of help from his friends. How about the offensive line? Albert Vimper, 77. Brandon Alcansell, 70. Josh Day, 76. Clint Oldenburg, 71. And Mike Brizell, 63. They're having a heck of a football game.
This is classic Sonny Lubick football, just grinding it out. Play action, nobody buys it. They throw it into the flat. Sperry inside the five. Are they going to give it to him? No sign from the official yet. No, they'll mark it at about the 1-inch line.
Right now, Corey Sperry is saying he's thinking about his parents. You made me 6'6". Couldn't you have gone for 6'7"?
6'7" would have helped. Yeah, really.
It's all I need, 1 inch. But what a beautiful call by Dan Hammerschmidt. Look at Sperry trying to get it there. What the official determined was the knee was down before he extended the ball over the goal line, because he definitely gets to the goal line. But he saw his body down first before he hit.
Fourth reception for Sperry. They're going for the 7, and Colorado stacks it up. With 5:45 to play in the third, Jimmy Green got the call and went nowhere quickly. Second and goal. Colorado State leads by 4. They're trying to up that.
I don't think that Colorado State really needs to get cute right here. I don't know if Justin Holland is the type of quarterback that you can have take the snap and duck behind those big fellas and hide his way into the end zone. That's about where I would go right now if he's that quarterback. If not, I come back and repeat something similar.
Yep.
Power at him, give the ball to the heavy-legged guy, 32, Jimmy Green, and go get it.
Sperry's back there with Green. Sperry shuttles around. Holland throws, hit, ball's tipped, caught, touchdown, Colorado State. Mike Bett marks the tight end. It looked like Jordan Dizon got a hand on it. Holland was leveling right as he let go of the football. Matt Barts did a great job of hauling that down.
Remember the first half on the other end of the field when Holland tried to hit Barts inside the 10-yard line and he was unable to come down with it? Remember that one?
Yep.
This time, great concentration because Dizon tipped the ball and Barts stayed with it and brought it down for the touchdown.
Now Kevin Mark drills the extra point, 21-20. Colorado State has taken an 11-point advantage over the Colorado Buffaloes. 5:04 to play in the third. College football on TBS, brought to you by Dodge. You can take life as it comes, or you can grab life by the horns. Dodge. And Chili's new triple dipper dinner. Come on, live a little. Just about 100 yards, 200 yards from the stadium, the beautiful creek. Matt Barts with the touchdown. Colorado State picked 5th in the Mountain West, leading Colorado, picked to win the North Division of the Big 12. Great concentration, though, by Barts on that touchdown reception.
Terrific, because as you noted to me in the break, it wasn't as if he was planted in the end zone. And, you know, he was falling as the ball was tipped, and it's almost like he willed his body to stay up and catch it. But here's the play that set it up. Watch all the direction go this way, and then Corey Sperry comes back this way. See him come back? He hid and came back against the wash. And once he came back inside, oh, my kingdom for an inch.
Oh, yeah. He didn't get the number, but he did help the cause a little bit there.
Love the call by Dan Hammerschmidt, the offensive coordinator.
Well, the Buffs find themselves down by 11. They're going to try to pound it. Keeping it on the ground with Charles. Now, there were two school of thoughts as far as Colorado and Colorado State. Colorado State, Sonny Lubick did something he hasn't done in the past. That's over the last 15 minutes of practice in the spring and now hitting, live hitting. Colorado went away from it. Colorado, we've seen fumbles. We've seen some problems. Is that the residue of maybe hitting and not hitting?
You know, Colorado went strong hitting in the spring, but felt they didn't have enough depth at the running back position to get those guys exposed in the fall. Plus, he felt he had a veteran team. So right now, what you're seeing is, if it stays this way,
sure that the residue is in favor of Colorado State.
Well, Dusty Sprague got it. But there's been some tackling issues, though, I think, with Colorado. I can't think how many missed tackles they've had in this game.
Yeah, they thought they tackled better than they had all spring long. And again, that's what led to Gary Barnett to his decision not to expose his guys to as much injury. Worried a little bit about depth, wanted them to be fresh for the season. Colorado State instead has hit all spring and all fall. And they seem to be a little bit crisper right now.
That's a third reception for Sprague. That covered 17 yards. But this has been Colorado's MO in this game. They move well in the middle of the field and they shoot themselves in the foot when they get deep into Colorado State territory. Last play action, scrambling for his life. Look out. Shakes one. Maybe gets back to the original line of scrimmage. Fans want a penalty flag. There it is. May have been out of bounds when they shoved him. Dangerous to do that when you shove the quarterback into his own bench.
And then give him an extra whack.
Not the smartest thing to do.
Usually don't have very many guys with your color shirt over there with you when that happens.
You're exactly right.
There is no flag on the penalty. No flag.
Well, this is going to get a reaction from Gary Barnett.
See, what they're saying is he was still going forward and trying to gain yardage and must have still, they must have felt he still was in bounds. There's Jamal Hall missing. Right, there's Smith. There's the shove. I think it's a good call. I think his feet were still in bounds when he got shoved. I think the problem you get when it's a quarterback is a heightened sensitivity. He shoved him out of bounds into his own bench. Ball goes flying, a few extra people, but his feet were still in the field of play in my estimation.
Well, that brings up second down. They lost a yard on that play. It's at 11. Charles, right side, and he is going to be swarmed over by the Colorado State defense as we check in with Ernie Johnson, Boise State and Georgia highlights. EJ?
A lot of folks wondering if possibly an upset would be in the works here, but Jared Zabransky threw two early picks for Boise State. Georgia turned them both into points. This DJ Shockley to Kenneth Harris to make it 14-0. Georgia in the first.
Ernie's taking a deep breath now.
See, that's just not right.
Yeah.
All right, my alma mater sweats, and his is off to a 14-zip lead.
Just the way it is.
Just the way it goes, right?
Third down and 12. Here comes the blitz. They rush five. Tip almost picked off at the last second. They wanted a pass interference. Sprague's calling for it, not going to get it. Mike Pagnotta was right there and almost came up with a loose ball.
Colorado's going to have to punt it away. Look in the middle. Yeah, he's there a little bit early.
Yeah.
But it's such a bang bang. See, it slowed down for us, so we could see the hands on the jersey, and then it comes down.
Well, now the fans are throwing things on the field, and we're not going to comment on it because that's so stupid. There was even an article in the paper today, an advertisement, pleading with the people, don't throw anything on the field.
And a great column about showing class in a rivalry game in a local paper, which I thought was terrific. Some people need to read that article and take it to heart.
Well, they were confiscating mushrooms, marshmallows, believe it or not. So we've got Texas Tech
tortillas.
Here they confiscate marshmallows. They got things under control. Torp set to kick it away. Another driving kick.
Got to be able to return that.
Oh, it hits at the three, and it's going to be down at the four. What a job again by John Torp. That is why he is the best in the country. 55 yards on the kick, and it hit like a sandwich.
And he faked me out.
We'll take a break. Colorado State with the football in the lead. Fans, now it's time for the Aflac trivia question. And the question is, what was Colorado's record after three games during its 1990 national championship season? We'll have the Aflac trivia question answer coming up in just a couple of minutes. Huge defensive stand for Colorado right now.
They've been struggling. They felt a couple calls went against them on offense. The fans got involved in a negative way. But the defense has them backed up. And if they want to get something going for their offense, they need to at least keep them down here and force them to punt out of their own end zone.
Allen does the audible. Give it to Bell. Up over the 5 to the 7. I take that check with Jimmy Green to the 7-yard line. Well, you can't do that. You got the guys in the hole. You can't give up a 5-yard gain.
And it was one that seemed to be defensed well to begin with, but they were unable to finish the play from the defensive perspective. And you know that when they ran on the field, Mike Hankwitz talked to his defense about, hey, we've got them backed up. Great place to force a turnover, guys.
Colorado moving a lot on defense. It looks like they're not sure where they want to line up. Second and 5. Up over the 10 to the 13-yard line. That'll be about a yard short of the first down. Again, it is Jimmy Green just lowering his head. Hey, we talked about John Torp. How about Torp and Crosby and what they've done? And Charles, you touched on it, but I tell you that's just like that's a whole extra weapon when 35% of the game's usually special teams.
And now you have to utilize it. If you are the Colorado defense, you can't let those numbers go to waste.
Yeah. Well, that was a first down. Didn't get enough, so they got out of the hole.
They got them down there. You've got to keep them backed up. They've given up one first down. They can't afford to give up another. Otherwise, the field position battle changes again against Colorado.
And Hammerschmidt doing a good job calling the play for Colorado State. Holland's pass almost picked off. J.J. Billingsley was reaching over the back, intended for Green. Now here's the last drive for Colorado State. Bell, then Green. And here's the play.
Corey Sperry running back against the grain. And then after the fake, how about the concentration by Bartz, the tight end?
That's a guy that's 6'3", 249, all padded up and still able to get the hands on it. Second down and 10 now for Colorado State. Again, Holland will change the play. Colorado backs off, penalty flag. There'll be some motion in the backfield. That'll shove him back 5 yards.
Prior to the snap,
may have been
ball
on the
start,
line.
Number 76 on the offense. 5-yard penalty, still second down.
Well, Josh Day out of Aurora, Colorado.
Yeah, the big throwback offensive lineman. They call him quiet but mean when he gets between the lines. They love the way that he plays. Maybe their best offensive lineman gets overlooked a little bit in terms of recognition. But they say he just brings the lunch pail, goes to work.
Yep. Most physical guy out there.
But this is the, now again, Colorado getting this a gift in a sense, must capitalize on it.
Allen, they try to draw some running room. Colorado closes quickly on Jimmy Green, Ryan Ewu. Spent most of the first half on the sideline. He is back, and that was huge. One of the captains of this team, and that'll bring up a fourth down. And it looks like it'll be about 9. Third down.
And that was what we just saw there, the benefit of playing zone coverage. What I mean by that was Colorado had a zone coverage, and that means the defensive guys, the linebackers in the secondary, able to keep their eyes forward towards the line of scrimmage. Ewu saw the play, came from his defensive drop, and made the tackle.
Third and 10. Robertson Walker to the right. Allen, the deep flat pass. That's going to be picked off. Lorenzo Sims. Sometimes Holland does try to force the ball. Was that a case of trying to do too much with not enough air?
Yes, and pressure. Because when he set up to throw the ball, the pressure was in his face. At that point, it was time to tuck it down, take the sack, and punt the ball away. That didn't happen. Colorado gets exactly what they were looking for. A big turnover deep in Colorado State's territory. That's how you help your offense and take advantage of the great stat we showed earlier about the kicking game helping out the Colorado defense.
Yeah, you can see the turnover situation. That's something that's really hurt Colorado with two. Colorado State now with one. Fumble it right back. It's still loose, still loose. Colorado State has it. Niles, Coach Avery, has an interception. Now he has a fumble recovery that was forced by Jamal Hall. I don't think that Colorado has any toes left. They shot themselves in the foot so many times today.
Well, if you go back to a point that you made earlier, you asked me about, how about these running backs who weren't hit much in the fall? What about ball security? That was a question we asked Gary Barnett in the meeting. And he said, well, we've done a lot of other drills having them work on ball security with Sean Sims, their running backs coach. They weren't hitting live contact, though. There's nothing like getting out into the middle of a game with young kids. And Gary Barnett freely admitted to us, we don't know what's going to happen with these kids. We think they'll be okay, but thus far, we're seeing early jitters from some youngsters.
Fourth fumble, they've lost two this afternoon. So they just blew a golden opportunity. Bell is tripped up, but not before he picks up 4 or 5. J.J. Billingsley is down. Coming off that knee surgery last year, only played in 2 games, and he is the pillar of strength for this defense.
Watching Bell starting to impose his will a little bit with his running, and Billingsley goes low and takes on one of those big thighs of Kyle Bell. Another tough, hard run. That's what they say. Football's not a contact sport. It's a collision sport.
Oh, yeah.
And there have been a number of collisions on both sides. Let me give you a quick perspective for defense right now. They just went to the heights, right? Got an interception, forced a turnover, gave the ball to their offense in a great spot. They're on the bench congratulating each other, happy, and all of a sudden you hear sudden change, which means you gotta go right back out onto the field. That's a tough one mentally to handle, so you gotta be careful here and watch to see if Colorado State tries to go deep and take advantage of them while they're unsettled.
Colorado State's defense has been on the field a lot. Bell has stood up. In fact, the Colorado State's offense is about +6 minutes as far as possession time, and it's warm out here.
I think Dan Hammerschmidt, the coordinator of Colorado State, is enjoying what his offensive line is giving him.
Oh yeah.
I've got to admit, I would have thought about taking a shot on second down. You know, you got a little bit unsettled defense coming back out there after what's happened. Time's going to run out here in the third quarter, which is good probably for Colorado to try and get a little bit of a blow. But I might have taken a shot downfield just to see if I could increase my luck.
Well, it was 14-10 at intermission, Colorado State. They tacked another touchdown on Bartz from Holland. That made it 21-10, and that is where we are right now. 1 quarter left. Can the Buffaloes extend their win streak over Colorado State to 3 games? Or will Colorado State have the bragging rights? Welcome back to TBS Saturday Night College Football presented by Orbitz. As we get set to start the fourth quarter, Colorado State leads at 21-10. Along with Craig Sager and Charles Davis, I'm Ron Thulin. 3rd down and 6 for Colorado State. Ball on their own 47-yard line.
4 wides, balanced set.
Colorado brings 4. The pressure collapses. There's a duck in the air, and it's picked off by Colorado again. The 2nd interception. Akarika Dawn coming down with a football. The senior out of Sugar Land, Texas.
The beneficiary of terrific pressure. I thought it was Abraham Wright, 53. From the right side of your screen. There he is. See him batting the ball? Great job by Wright. Couldn't get there for the sack, but got an arm up and forced a bad throw. And Akarika Dawn, a former defensive back, now playing linebacker, gets a 2nd interception in 2 possessions. 2 great stops by the Colorado defense.
Hey, the Colorado offense better do their share.
It's time for them to pick up their share of the load, isn't it?
Absolutely. Flat. Dumps it off in the flat to Vickers. He is just hog-tied at the 48-yard line. He may even lose a yard on that play. Morton Jones is there for the stop. Now, if you don't think this is a big game for these two teams, back in 2002, Colorado State won 19-14. Colorado went on to win the North Division. 1st of 3, Colorado State people said, we don't care. We beat you. And they keep reminding them of that little fact.
And then you flip it around, and Colorado State ended up in a bowl game when Colorado beat them 1 year, and the Buffalo fans said, forget the bowl game, yep, we beat you guys.
That's right. It's beautiful. It's a wonderful thing. He did lose a yard on that play. don't know where Platt was throwing that ball. It was intended for Patrick Williams, a redshirt freshman who was on a streak pattern right down the sideline. Okay, but it's been a series of turnovers in this half. Allen, he's picked off by Sims. Then we have Charles with a fumble. And then Holland goes and returns the favor. He's picked off by Darn. So somebody has to capitalize on this.
And what I think Gary Barnett's wondering right now is his offensive line is allowing a lot of pressure in the face of Joel Klatt. They're going to have to stand up and be stout and give their quarterback a chance to throw the football.
Klatt rifles it over the middle. Pass is complete inside the 30-yard line down to the 28. Joe Kroffenstein, his third reception of the game.
Kroffenstein, number 89, running into the seam. And Klatt finds him and gets him the ball. And what I've been impressed about with the Colorado tight ends is the way they adjust to the football. He was running inside. The ball came back on the outside of him. He adjusted and made another fine catch. And what happened on that play? Good pass protection for Joel Klatt, able to step up and throw a strike.
Well, Gary Barnett said he was not sure of the passing game. He's afraid they're going to lock down on two of their wide receivers and just sit back and wait. Trying to open things up now. Klatt, empty backfield, going down the sideline. Pass is incomplete. Looking for Evan Judge. May have been shoved out of bounds anyway.
And the tough thing for Gary Barnett is he's got a couple of starters that have been dinged up on the offensive line.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't think that Brandon Daniels has been able to. Brian Daniels has come back into the ballgame since going off in the first half, and he has All-American potential. And Tyler Columbus, number 77, he's been dinged up a lot also. Came into the game with a bad shoulder.
Right.
And he was hurt earlier, as Craig Sager reported to us.
That was a quick toss. Some running room. Charles breaks it. Touchdown, Colorado. Gary Barnett says he's the fastest guy he's ever had. He makes up for the fumble, takes the corner, dances into the end zone, and Gary Barnett wants to go for two.
And he looks at the scoreboard and realizes if he gets two, he's only down three. Now, if you've listened to us in the past, I'm not huge on chasing points. But I think Gary Barnett's wondering how many opportunities he will have.
That's right.
So he wants to get them now. They are in the fourth quarter. So he wants to get it and make it a three-point game, if at all possible.
Victors and Charles in the backfield. Colorado State moving around on defense. 4-2. Klatt rolling out, buying some time, has a man in the end zone, caught, it's good. Evan Judge coming down with the ball. You, Charles, showed that speed, the sophomore out of South Lake, Texas. Second collegiate touchdown makes it look easy. Then they decide to go for two. Klatt doing a good job of buying some time, has the pressure on him, finds Judge. And now we've got a three-point ball game with 13:32 left. We told you at the top of the show the last three games between these two teams, margin of victory was 5. It's at 3 now. Colorado State has led most of the way. It's 21-18, but still a lot of time left here in the fourth quarter. Along with Craig Sager and Charles Davis, I'm Ron Thulin. Let's see what kind of poise Colorado State has now.
Yeah, they have to remember, they're not behind.
That's right.
You know, they've had back-to-back turnovers. It hasn't felt right, but they're still in the lead.
High end over end kick. George Hill from right of the goal line. He is going to make it up to the 25-yard line. Now, one of the great quarterbacks here at Colorado is a guy by the name of Cordell Stewart. He's with our Craig Sager right now.
Well, thanks, Ron. Cordell Stewart played in this game 4 times, going as far as starting as a freshman. Tell us a little bit about what it means for a Colorado alum to come back here and try to beat Colorado State.
Well, I mean, just to come back and be a part of the camaraderie of the team and the city and the fans and how they enjoy it, it means a lot. But this game right here is all about in-state claims and rights and all that good stuff. And I remember when I played and we spanked them pretty good. I'm going to say it out loud. So it looked like we're getting a chance to spank them pretty soon. So we're down by, what, 3? Still got time. Fourth quarter. You never know what happens, right?
We're used to seeing you, obviously, in the NFL Sundays. You're back here just one class away from graduating. Congratulations on your pending graduation. But still, looking at you, you can still play in the NFL. Any chances you're going to try to come back?
Oh, yeah, I still can play. I'm still fresh, still young. It's just a matter of where can I fit in. And I'm still playing. I'm still playing. Just a matter of waiting on that phone call,
How are you working out?
I'm sorry?
How do you work out?
Well, I work down in Atlanta with my trainer, Rope Man, down in off of Buford Highway. He worked with me real good, so just getting it done, just maintaining, lifting, running, throwing, doing everything I can to stay in shape.
Congratulations on the graduation. Wish you the best.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right, Craig, it's 2nd and 10 for Colorado State. Holland going deep, has a man, got a step on the defense. It's going to be incomplete, and Lorenzo Sims was step for step with George Hill, who started to separate. That'll bring up a 3rd down and 10.
One thing about Lorenzo Sims, you gotta love his effort. See the wrap on his left leg?
Yeah.
That's not for show, all right? That's not a style thing for him.
Mm-hmm.
He has a bad knee. He has an injured toe that they say needs surgery, but if he gets it, he's probably out 2 years. You know, he's taking cortisone shots to be able to play. He's one of the toughest kids that you're going to find in college football, and he's played a nice ball game here today.
Corey Sperry's in the slot, Anderson to the near side on 3rd down and 10.
Where do you go on a 3rd and 10 if you're Colorado State? Think number 4.
Looking for Anderson. There he is. He's got it. Up to the 34-yard line, but he will be short of the first down. Tyrone Henderson corralled him, but what a hit Anderson took, but still held out of the football.
Jarrett Burrow, number 31, in coverage, runs him inside. Tom Hubbard reads the play, comes there, and Tyrone Henderson also. Remember earlier how open he got on a 3rd and long play? And we said, if you're going to err on the side of covering the guy you know can hurt you. They just did it there. He attracted so much attention, leads to a punt. Another great series, the 3rd in a row by the Colorado defense.
Well, Joe Kearney almost got just totally wrapped up the last time as the rush came straight up the middle. And he was dropped. Here comes the rush again. Good kick. That's going to be a penalty. You can't do that. Stephon Robinson had no chance.
Yeah, it looked like LaDon Levine, number 28, a backup defensive back, did not locate the football. And that's going to cost them big yardage. Yeah, my coach in college, Johnny Midge, used to talk about penalties and what happens in the kicking game, the area of hidden yardage.
That's
you know, we might not note it in the stats, but that's going to change field position.
And this is going to change it a lot.
Kick catch interference on the kicking team, number 28. 15-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down.
Well, instead of the ball being inside the 20-yard line, somewhere down about the 12, Colorado's going to get decent field position. They have plenty of time to work with. 12:20 to play in the fourth. They only trail by 3. Now it's time to give the answer to tonight's Aflac trivia question. The question was, what was Colorado's record after 3 games during its 1990 national championship season? And the answer is 1-1-1. Colorado won 10 straight after the start, including their Orange Bowl victory over Notre Dame.
That split the national title with Georgia Tech that year, Bobby Ross's team.
Vickers, not much running room. You know, when Blake Mackey went down, one of the outstanding receivers for Colorado, Evan Judge went to the other receivers, including the young guys, and said, guys, we got to step up. Now it's time. Today, we've seen these receivers play a lot better than they did last year, and the tight ends. I think they've all stepped up their game about a half a notch.
And I give some of that credit to Sean Watson, the offensive coordinator. When they lost their wide receivers coach, Ted Gilmore, he took the wide receivers under his wing and brought them into meetings with the quarterbacks, trying to develop a bond and a trust, and also having both of them see what the other guy is seeing. And I think we're seeing the benefits of that.
Still trying to pound it out. Charles over the 40-yard line, up to about the 48-yard line. Yeah, Hugh Charles, the youngster from South Lake, Texas, doing a good job today outside of one fumble.
And this is why Gary Barnett was gushing about him. You get him into open field with his speed and strength, he can make big plays for you. And he has done that today. And that last run that he had, that's the type of run that inspires an offensive line to block harder for you. He made something out of nothing, and those guys will redouble their efforts to help a guy like that from now on.
Into the flat, penalty flag is thrown. That's going to be pass interference, but the pass is caught by Judge. Did a great job of fighting off. Uh-oh. Sonny Lubick's not going to be happy. Same guy that had the interference on the fair catch comes up with the interference on the pass. For Don Levine. Now they're going to call it holding instead. Doesn't matter, still hurts.
Watch Judge working to the outside, coming there. You see he's got him. He's pretty much wrapped up on him and locked up the whole way. That's why it was called a hold. But how about Evan Judge's strength? The hand fight his way through and then use his body, and how competitive he was for the football. He decided it was his and not the defender's and went and took it.
It's a kid that just does everything right. Came on as a walk-on, continued to work hard, got awarded the scholarship, but he just does everything right for this program.
Now, he and his family put about $60,000 into his education before he was awarded the scholarship. Yeah. Can they get that back retroactively?
I wish.
I don't think the NCAA will let him, but.
No, defensive holding, number 28. That's a 10-yard penalty from the line of scrimmage. Automatic first down.
So that takes away a great reception by Evan Judge, but it helps the team because more yardage was gained by taking the penalty. So that's a true example of taking one for the squad.
That is exactly. You lose the stat, but you pick up a couple of yards. Why not? 10:51 to play. First and 10. Ball on the Colorado State 48-yard line.
And penalty situation now pretty much even. Going to a bunch formation here with the three receivers. We'll see how they scatter.
I'll go to the right. Charles inside the 40. This young man got his pilot's license his sophomore year of high school, but he's flying tonight. Nading on the stop.
And a hold on the Colorado offensive front.
Oh boy, oh boy.
Each time they get a nice drive going, a good big play, they hurt themselves and bring it back. The good thing is,
number 58 on the offense, 10-yard penalty from the line of scrimmage. Repeat first down.
The positive for the Colorado offensive line, although after a hold and erasing a run like that, it's hard to find it. Tyler Palumba, 77, back in the ball game.
Yeah.
Right, Brian Daniels, 66, back in the ball game. He's been back in the ball game. I saw him on the field previously. That time it was on Mark Fenton, their center, who they say has become so good at finishing blocks. He was a terrific offensive lineman this spring for them.
Young redshirt freshman Patrick Williams gets up to the 45-yard line. That'll be a pick of about three. Heretic and Garcia there to stop him. Closing in on 10 minutes to play in the fourth. Our first and 10 line is brought to you by Napa. That first and 10 line for Colorado is about 17 yards away.
That screen took a long time to develop.
Yeah.
It's a wide receiver screen, and they were counting on the offensive lineman to get out there and help him. Kind of a jailbreak type of a screen. But it took so long to develop that the Colorado State guys got underneath it and spoiled it.
Second and 17. Here comes the rush. Platt is going to be dropped back at the 35-yard line. Miles Koshaver just continued to add to his stats. Fumble recovery, interception, now a sack. Throw in three tackles just for the heck of it.
And he's put pressure on the quarterback earlier in the ball game. He's going to come from the top of the screen. Miles Koshaver, the strong safety, coming up through the gap and gets to Joel Klatt. Watch out, comes free. See him come right through, totally unblocked. And he makes a big play. Now, I do remember my coaches saying, Davis, if no one blocks you and you don't make a play,
really.
That's when I'll really be mad. But in any event, a nice play by Miles Koshaver.
Third down in the bundle, 26 for Colorado, trailing by three. Pressure again, they slip it underneath the cover. Barnett, and he is going to be dropped after he crosses the 40 up to about the 43-yard line. Alvin Barnett, the sophomore out of Tulsa, Oklahoma, East Central High School in Tulsa. They're going to be forced to kick it away. Now, the last time Colorado kicked, Torp had an outstanding punt that Colorado couldn't take advantage of. Let's see what happens now.
And provided Colorado State doesn't do anything wrong in the kicking game here, a great defensive possession for them, sorely needed for their confidence as the momentum had started to shift toward the guys in black and gold.
And he drills another one. Two of his three punts have been inside the 20. Osborne trips up over the 15-yard line to the 18-yard line. 52-yard kick again for John Torp. We're going to take a break. 8:05 to play. Colorado State clinging to the 3-point lead. When we come back, we'll have the football on their own 18-yard line.
We got about 30 seconds to tee time, right? 73, we got heads up for cues, right? Heads up for cues this week. Nice, nice, keep coming. Well done, in the huddle. Good job, O-line. Come on, get him in and out today, Zach. Got a lot of work to do, man. Heads up, here we go. Just want to let you guys know I hate being mic'd up.
Coach, you won't mic yet next Saturday as TBS continues college football, 7 o'clock Eastern. Wake Forest travels to Lincoln to take on the Nebraska Cornhuskers and Coach Callahan. Colorado State now has the luxury of 7:59 to try to waste. Colorado with two timeouts, the Rams with three, but they have the advantage. Is this a case that you want to do, be smart on your offense, but you can't do things that are uncharacteristic for you, right? I mean, you don't want to be, you know, too passive.
And you can't go into a shell because of the two interceptions. You got to talk to your guys about protecting your passer better and give him the opportunity to throw the football. But at the same time, know where you are on the field. You're still ahead. And when you got explosive runs as you just got on first down, that really eases what you're doing on offense.
They're just going to keep it on the ground, and that'll be a first down for Colorado State. First stop. Namdi O'Hare was expected to be the featured running back for this Colorado State offense. He was injured. Kyle Bell, the sophomore, has taken over the running load. And they really wanted to find that featured running back, I think. I think Colorado State, you know, you like to play two, but most coaches want to play one.
And Kyle Bell is making a case for it. Namdi O'Hare limped off the field earlier today. Kyle Bell has stepped into the breach and has run the football pretty well all day long.
Absolutely. He'll try it again. He is picking up 3, 4, 5 yards of chunk. Lorenzo Sims with his 7th tackle.
And earlier in the game, I gave a lot of credit to the offensive line of Colorado State, named them all and talked about what they've done. Think about this. They are starting two guys on the offensive line that are converted H-back tight ends.
Mm-hmm.
All right, Brandon Alkinsell, a former tight end, caught one ball last year. Clint Oldenburg played guard last year but had been a tight end before that. He's now a tackle, and I'm loving the body lean that Kyle Bell is running with. Even when he's tackled, he's moving forward.
Able to put it up, passes tipped, falls harmlessly incomplete. Walter Boydoe got the hand on it. Let's take a look back at our keys we told you about in that opening quarter. Let's go to Colorado State first, Charles.
Yeah, the toughness up front on the O-line and D-line, the rush yards are really starting to pile up. They've held Colorado to 109. That's pretty good. Finding a feature back, Bell stepping into the breach with 65 yards. Controlled aggressiveness, 67% completion. He's been under control. The two interceptions, that's the downside. One of them definitely wasn't his fault. Bell hit while he was trying to throw the ball.
Third down and 4, inside of 6.5. A must-stop situation for the Bucs. They go to Anderson. Gets the first down. Penalty flag is thrown as he crosses the 45 up to the 47. Anderson's 10th reception of the afternoon. And it's going to be a hold.
Holding on the offense, number 92. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Repeat third down. 10 yards right there.
And that's Matt Bartz, the tight end, trying to block on the wide receiver screen. And they picked up the first down, but all for naught. But this guy, if you watch him play just one time, if you don't have admiration for him or have respect, then I'm not sure what you're watching.
I agree.
He's the quintessential college football player. Loves the game, passionate about it, and the toughness. How about that last catch? 9 receptions today, 1 touchdown for the last catch, and then he ducks inside and puts his head down to get the first down. Not dancing to the sidelines, not trying to go down.
I tell you what, he's an impressive young man.
Give me 11 David Andersons any day.
Absolutely, they need him now. 3rd and 10, and it is loud at Folsom Field. Howard into the flat, caught by Matt Bartz. It'll be short of the first down. He's right at the 40. Needed to get up to about the 43.5 yard line. So with 5:51, Colorado will get the ball back. Maybe.
Now they need a good kick out of the gold shoe guy, Jimmy Kaler. He's got to change field position and help out his defense here.
Now he's not trying to be flashy. The reason he wears a gold shoe is they don't make a black one. It's a soccer shoe.
In that style shoe. That's the shoe that Ronaldo, the great Brazilian soccer star, wears. What do you say? Red, gold,
and blue.
And blue, and that's it.
He picked the right color. Taylor, good snap. Here comes the rush. He barely gets it away, but it's a good kick. Robinson shakes one tackle. Look out. Gets a block. Gets another block. Oh, my! He's got running room. Penalty flag is thrown. He gets up to the 45-yard line. With Colorado State's Jeff Horenick was detonated at the 12-yard line, and he is still down. Sonny Lubick's coming over to make sure he's okay. Boy, he got, I'm telling you, you better make sure that he hears a bunch of phones ringing. He's just not sure where they are.
In the back, number 43 of the return team. Half the distance for the goal line. First down.
Now they're calling it a block in the back, so the 52-yard return is negated, and they're going to bring it back. Looking at it again. We're going to have to take a look at that one again. We'll take a break. 4:58 to play. College football on TBS brought to you by Kia Motors. Kia, the power to surprise. By TIAA Kreft, financial service for the greater good. By Orbitz, log on to Orbitz.com today, book your hotel and flight together and save. It's that easy, Orbitz and go. And by Star Motorcycles from Yamaha. We build it, you make it yours. 4:58 to play. Along with Charles Davis, Craig Sager, I'm Ron Thulin. That penalty was not on the hit on Horenick, by the way. It was after that. That was a clean hit. But nevertheless, Colorado is backed up. They have to treat this like this is the last drive of the game. Platt's got a man open. First down over the 35-yard line. Up to about the 38-yard line. Dusty Sprague. His fourth reception, none bigger than that one.
And this is good coaching by Sean Watson. A great route by Dusty Sprague. But the reason I say it's good coaching is because LaDon Levine, number 28, is in the game out at the corner. Daryl Williams, the starter, is not in. It's an old adage in coaching. Hey, if the second guy's in, go after him, because if he were that good, he would have been starting. So go test him out. And Dusty Sprague did and found him wanting on that play.
33-yard pickup. Again, has another man over. Klopfenstein inside the 40, down to the 37-yard line, his fourth reception. That's the Joel Klatt we thought we would have seen in the first half.
Running in the seams, linebacker trying to run underneath, unable to do so. Renick's not there. Courtney Jones left way behind, and they're able to get the ball to Klopfenstein before the safeties can come over and make any kind of a play on the football.
We have another player down. I don't want to speculate who it is. Looks like it's Matt Rupp.
Or Quinn Sidnewski from Colorado.
Yep.
A 6-year senior tight end. That's a guy's had some tough luck along the way. You documented it earlier.
Yeah. Now we got a timeout in the action here. Let's check in with Ernie Johnson in Atlanta for a little Washington update. EJ?
Thank you, Ron. The debut with the Huskies for Tyrone Willingham, and looked good for a while. Isaiah Standback, the quarterback, pump fake into the air to Cody Ellis, 27 yards, 17-6 lead. It was 17-13, under a minute to go, Air Force. Sean Carney with the sneak, makes it 20-17. About 14 seconds to play in that game as Washington is trying to drive to a tying field goal. We'll keep you posted, too.
All right, EJ, thanks. Todd Willingham's going to do a great job at Washington. Colorado back out of the attack. Clapp tries to slip away. Tucks the football and just takes the seed, and he'll lose about 5 on the play. Delroy Park with his first sack. That's the third for the team. Now, when Stepniewski went off the field, I'll tell you what, he pointed at somebody at Colorado State and says, I've got your number. He was hot. Watch this.
Wasn't real happy about the blow he received.
I got you. I'll tell you what, if I saw him in a dark alley, I'd go the other way, too.
Let me help you with this one, Ron. I don't need a dark alley. All right? I see him just fine in the daylight.
I think it's the do-rag. And Ranger, Iowa.
And he's back out there to try and pay off on that one.
Second down and 15. Clear on the play clock. 2-1. He gets it off in time. Black steps up, lets it fly, has a man complete up to the 32-yard line. Patrick Williams, the redshirt freshman. Jamal Hall was chasing Platt around, still able to get it away. Closing in on 3 to play. Third down and 3.
Love the presence of Joel Klatt being able to step inside of Jamal Hall's rush and deliver downfield. And how about the redshirt freshman, Patrick Williams, not trying to do anything spectacular, just securing the catch.
Yeah. And his first collegiate reception tonight. Clock is moving. Hoffenstein's in the slot, goes across the middle. Clack steps up. Pass. Good defensive effort by Colorado State. Miles Cochaver, who has had an outstanding game, got his hand on it.
Look at Cochaver inside and gets his. Wow, that's, he even got the upfield arm in front. Trying to get it and pull it in for the interception to kill the drive, because Mason Crosby is well within his range.
They're going to mark it at the 38-yard line. This is a 48-yard attempt for Crosby. He was 3 of 5 within this distance last year. Good snap. This kick is on its way. Splits the uprights, and it is good. The nation's best kicker has tied the game. You see last year's numbers, this guy's nickname should be automatic.
Look at the 30 to 40 yards and then 50 plus. Yeah. 5 of 8, including a 60-yarder.
And he's celebrating his 21st birthday today. We talked to Gary Barnett on Thursday night, and he said, he goes, yeah, it's pretty good practice today. Crosby was sitting back there hitting 62-yarders. He says he's clearing the uprights by a lot.
What impresses me most about Mason Crosby and Torp, John Torp, the punter, is the ease in the way that they hit the ball. You know, it's a lot of guys, when they go for the big shot, there's a real almost violence in how they go about it. These guys look the same whether they're pooching it or bombing it. It's amazing.
2:32. Colorado State will have to work with. They want to avoid overtime. Crosby set to kick it away. A line driver. Hill looking for the wedge. Nothing there. Gets pushed back right at the 20-yard line. Stay tuned after our game. The Atlanta Braves look to take the second game of their series against the visiting Cincinnati Reds. The Braves took game one last night, 7-4. Chipper Jones, homer. Pitcher Tim Hudson added a triple. That'll be coming up. Reds-Braves next on Braves TBS Baseball.
All right, let's set this up. The story of the second half has been the Colorado defense after the first flurry by Colorado State.
But right now, Sonny Lubick and his staff have told his team there cannot be a three and out on offense. That leaves Colorado too much time if they get the ball back. They've got to get some first downs.
And there's that defense swarming around Kyle Bell again. James Gary, the senior out of Colorado Springs Mitchell High School, comes up to make the stop. This is a young man that was just 205 pounds when he signed with CU. Put him about 275 now. Billingsley is back, so he's okay.
That's good eating and good time in the weight room. Exactly. Just slap that on. But see, if you're Colorado State, you're not playing to get to overtime, but you're also not wanting to put yourself in a spot for an easy score for Colorado, as we see the total yards here in the second half.
Especially with Colorado having Crosby. Holland looking, throwing. Oh, he throws it into coverage again. Burrow picks it off. He's at the 25, goes down at the 22-yard line. The second time Holland has made an ill-advised throw into traffic. Mike Hankwitz yesterday, we said, do you want to make him run around? He says he's not as good when he does that.
And that was his worst throw of the day, because it's one he has to eat. He knows the position his team is in. You're backed up a little bit. You don't, what did I just say? You don't want to give them an easy opportunity.
That's, right.
That's exactly what Justin Holland just did. The most ill-advised throw that he's had. And how about them in the second half? Touchdown, interception, interception, punt, punt, interception, Colorado State on offense.
Colorado is already within field goal range. Charles. Oh, what a move. Again, to the outside. Goodbye, Utahs. State lost in the final 30 seconds and they were heartbroken. They led most of the way tonight, and now they find themselves down with a minute and a half left. Crosby for the extra point. The lead is at 7.
How about the suddenness of this move? I mean, he took his whole body and moved it from one place. Oh, look at that. And the slide and the vision. And then he goes inside and again freezes Travis Garcia and then gets to the outside. And once he's there, say goodnight, Gracie. He's in the end zone.
Sam Polis, who works up in the booth with us, just said Barry Sanders.
That was that type of a move.
One, wasn't it? We're going to take a timeout. 1:30 to play in the ballgame. Colorado's trailed all the way. They got their first lead. Colorado State fans cannot believe it's happening to them again. They've lost 2 in a row to Colorado. One was a heartbreaker. But they still have a minute and a half left. And they have a quarterback that, despite the interceptions, is extremely talented. Crosby boots this one through the end zone. Here's Ernie Johnson in Atlanta.
All right, thank you, Ron. Folks, if you've been tuning in to watch Andrew Jones and the Braves take on the Reds, it is coming your way soon, as soon as Colorado and Colorado State have concluded things out there in Boulder. Yeah, you'll be seeing Jeff Franco in the game. Back to you, Ron.
All right, thanks, EJ. Our situation, 1:30 to play, 28-21. Colorado State trails now by 7.
The offensive staff of Colorado State, the running back you have on the field must be your best pass protector, because you've got to throw the football. Remember, first down, stop the clock in college football. And Colorado State has 3 timeouts at their disposal, plenty of time to move the ball downfield.
Low snap, Collins got it. Pass to no one in particular. Before the last touchdown, Here's why we call Joel Klatt a coach on the field. Look at him talking to his team, but watch who he talks to at the last second when they're running out. Turns, the man who scored. That's you.
That C stands for captain on his jersey. Might as well stand for coach. It's a dual, it should be a dual C. And look at the difference first half, second half. Yardage in particular, and no interceptions in the second half.
Osborne Roberts and Sperry come to the near side. Anderson to the far side. Second and 10. Sperry's open. They don't see him. They get it to Anderson. Complete over the 40, up to the 43-yard line. The clock will stop with 1:20 to go. That's Anderson's 11th catch of the day.
And on this play, Colorado rushed 4 and dropped 7. Not much pressure this time on Holland. Gave him an opportunity to find Anderson curling inside. Don't be surprised if Mike Hankwitz shows the 4 down lineman and eventually decides to rush one of the linebackers to put a little more heat on Holland.
Pick up the 22. Holland has time. Pass into the flat, complete in Colorado territory to Luke Roberts. Clock is stopped at 1:10. Another first down. Roberts' first reception.
Clock stops to move the chains. They get up on the line of scrimmage, save themselves some time, don't have to use a timeout. If I'm Mike Hankwitz, back-to-back plays, no pressure on the quarterback. He's picking me apart. I might want to think about bringing someone for a little pressure here.
The linebackers are about 7 yards off the line of scrimmage. They don't bring them. Holland going deep, looking for the home run. Has a man. Incomplete to David Anderson. Sims got a hand on it. Anderson did everything he could, and his gas tank is close to empty.
Beautifully thrown ball. Great concentration by Anderson, but the credit has to go to the defensive back, Sims. Felt when Anderson was going for the football, sees it, gets his hand up in between to throw off the concentration a little. It hit him right on the number 4, but I really think the hand up hurt the concentration of Anderson. Now he needs a blow.
Roberts and John Walker to the right. Sperry joins him on the right side. Second and 10, they swing it out to Sperry. Looks for a block, gets one. Runs out of bounds, but not before he gets up to the 40-yard line.
That was an intelligent reception by Corey Sperry. Realizing what the time factor is with the clock, catches it instead of taking it up inside, moves to the outside so he can get out of bounds.
Third down and 4. Holland and Klatt have faced each other twice in high school. They each won one. Holland winning the last, throwing a touchdown pass in the last minute. The safety that he went over, Joel Klatt.
They continue to rush 4 and drop 7. Holland's had some time to find receivers.
Third and 4. The rush, the pass, complete to Sperry. Another first down, and the clock will stop with 46 seconds to play. And I think Colorado State's going to burn a timeout. They'll have 2 remaining, each team with 2 after this one. Coach Hammerschmidt has done an excellent job in his play calling today. Welcome back to TBS Saturday Night College Football presented by Orbis. And we have had a dandy. Colorado State led most of the way. Colorado has taken the lead in the 4th. Colorado State has it with 46 seconds, and we'd like to thank Orbis for being part of our family throughout this season. That kind of tells it all, doesn't it? Colorado State, formerly Colorado A&M. They're considered the Aggie school. Totally different cultures between these two schools, and that's probably the biggest understatement in the world.
It's like that in a lot of states, you know, with the state school versus what some people would term the agricultural school. So many different strengths play into it. Okay, as I look at this, with the ball where it is on about the 32-yard line, first and 10 for Colorado State, Justin Holland has had a chance to play pitch and catch going down the field. David Anderson is back on the field now, the wide receiver for Colorado State. If you're going to take a shot at the end zone, you might want to think about it now. as we look at Justin Holland in the second half, the three interceptions, the big thing. The reason I say take the shot now, you have field to play with.
That's right.
The closer in you get, the less the defenders have to drop, and the back of the end zone becomes an extra defender.
First and 10, 46 seconds left in the ballgame. Holland scrambling, looking down the sideline, still looking, throws, passes, caught and complete to David Anderson again. His 12th reception, he's over 100 yards. His 11th 100-yard game for his career.
You know what my surprise has been on this drive? I think I've expressed it, the rushing four and dropping seven. Because they talked about last year that they just kept giving up yardage by playing conservative. No pressure on Justin Holland. He's having a lot of time to find receivers. And now is where it gets tough because you don't have as much room to roam with your receivers.
Holland again going into the end zone. Touchdown! Penalty flag is thrown. Hold on. Sperry is the guy who caught it. We're not sure. This may be offensive interference.
That's what you're hoping if you support black and gold. If it's green and gold, you're thinking it's a hold on the Buffaloes. J.J. Billingsley was on the coverage, number five.
Well, no.
Pass interference, number five on the defense. That penalty's declined. Touchdown.
Well, last year's hero in the game, J.J. Billingsley, he stopped Colorado State on the goal line. Comes up with a pass interference, loses the coverage, and this is for the tie.
This is a young man who has not been the normal kicker for his career. Coming into this game today, one PAT in his career that he's made.
Kevin Mark, a senior from Coral Springs, Florida. High snap, the extra point. And we are tied with 36 seconds left. But you don't want to go anywhere. Colorado's got a field goal kicker that has hit a 60-yarder. Here's the touchdown again.
Right there, J.J. Billingsley, number five. You see he's got an arm hooked around him, but Corey Sperry's too strong, goes right through it and makes the catch for a touchdown. You know, they always tell us in this business, second guessing's no good. You got to first guess, right?
Right.
I feel like I first guessed early in this drive, dropping seven and rushing four, and Justin Holland played pitch and catch all the way down the field.
That's right, he did.
Which really surprised me in their defensive strategy.
CSTV All Access. Listen to live games and view press conferences, coaches' shows, exclusive athlete features, and more. All on your computer. Go to CSTV.com to sign up. Now we talked about Corey Sperry, just a sophomore. Had one touchdown rushing last year, two receiving. He's done a great job, but this is the man that I think Colorado State is fearing the most right now. Mason Crosby, 60-yarder last year. We saw him boot a 65-yarder today, warming up.
And because of him, that alters your strategy if you're kicking the ball off for Colorado State. You might think about kicking deep, because if you squib it and give up too much of a chunk of yardage, you give it, you know, you give them a chance to get him in the field goal range earlier. I want them pinned back as deep as I can because of that young man's leg.
Well, it's a squib, but it's a deep squib. Robinson mishandles it. Has room up the middle. Still has room. Up to the 40-yard line. Let's have a quick update with Ernie in Atlanta. EJ.
All right, thank you very much, Ron. As we watch this game in its waning stages, or overtime possibly looming, I'll let you know that at Turner Field they are underway. Jorge Sosa on the mound for the Braves. Two down in the first, with a runner at first and Adam Dunn at the plate. We will be taking it to Turner Field for the Braves and the Reds after Colorado State and Colorado. Ron?
All right, Ernie, we've got 30 seconds and plus maybe 5-minute overtime coming up.
And they just need 20 yards to be well within Mason Crosby's range.
Colorado State blitzes. They find Patrick Williams. He is within range of the field goal. The clock stops with 25 left. 22 yards on the pickup.
They have two timeouts, so if you're Colorado, you don't necessarily have to throw the ball here. You know, you can run the ball, put it in the middle of the field. They probably want a few more yards just to feel better, but you're well within Mason Crosby's range. You're there.
It's a 55-yarder about right now. Here comes the blitz. Platt gets away from it, throws it away. He's outside the tackle. I think somebody went left instead of going right. Here's Crosby today during warmups. He's on the 45-yard line. Now watch this. Boom. You know, you think of Sebastian Janikowski, the way the ball exploded off his foot, similar.
Same kind of sound.
Yeah.
As it comes off. We went out to practice on Wednesday, and immediately our attention was drawn to the thumps. And thump doesn't do it justice.
No.
It is more like an explosion off of his foot.
You saw how far that ball went into the end zone. Now we have had an exciting fourth quarter, needless to say, here at Folsom Field. The first, a field goal. And then Hugh Charles turns on the Jets. He is an outstanding runner. And then Sperry ties the game up. And that's where we are right now. 28-28, 13 seconds left. Let's see what Gary Barnett, Sean Watson decide to do as far as getting the ball either in the middle of the field or maybe taking at least one more shot at it. What do you think?
I'd just try and move it towards the middle of the field and gain a few yards, great. But you know, with him, you're talking 50-something yards. It's not the same. Sure, your accuracy, you want it closer. But would you rather take your chance with Mason Crosby? I'd say yes.
Yeah.
You don't want to do anything right here that will take the chance out of his foot, off of his foot.
Pass out of the flat, down to the 31-yard line. Dusty Sprague with 9 seconds left. You bring him in now?
I think you think about it, because if something goes wrong, you still have 9 seconds on the clock.
Here he comes.
And that play called by Sean Watson, put it on the right hash mark, and for a right-footed kicker, soccer style, that's the place you want to be. Because now he can pretty much take a full pass at it. He doesn't have to punch it from the other hash mark. Now you can just go ahead and let it rip.
Nick Holtz is the holder. They're spotting it. The 37-yard line. It is a 47-yarder for the win. They've done it again to Colorado State. Tell you what, that had room to spare, Charles. You know, we talked with Joel Klatt, told us about it's like having a warm blanket around you, having a guy like that.
Look at Coach Barnett exulting.
Yeah.
There's never a doubt about Mason Crosby getting a good shot at it.
No.
I mean, whether it had been from the previous line of scrimmage or after the last pass, it didn't matter.
Now you still have 4 seconds left, so we don't want to be too premature, but
now
you do the squib and.
Yes. Yeah. Now I go back. See, before with Colorado State, because of Crosby, I wanted that ball as deep as you could get it and trust your cover guys to make tackles. The squib kick, even though it got deep, it opened up lanes for them. That hurt them because they only needed 20 yards to even get into range for them. They got that on the first play. So now you're Colorado State. Your only choice now is, it's gonna be, if they squib it, you gotta try the old Stanford lateral play and try and keep it alive.
Anderson and Walker are in the middle now. They're the good hands guys in case there is a squib. Herbert and Hill are back. Crosby, oh, he's gonna pop it up. Interesting.
Well, now if he just takes a knee in the end zone, no time comes off.
He better take a knee, and he does. And now they're gonna force him to go for the win.
4 seconds, Hail Mary is all you've got.
Yep.
But
interesting strategy.
Interesting strategy, because now you're relying on your defense. No balls popped up in the air. No extra tip. Craig Sager talked to Cordell Stewart today.
Yeah.
They remember what happened for Colorado at Michigan with a tip ball in the last play.
Well, Colorado State will use a timeout. Well, they're not going to use it.
You just got to put your guys back. No one gets behind you. Bat the ball down. You can't let it be tipped up in the air for someone else to come along and grab it and make a play. He's got a monster arm, but his coaches have told us that he can throw it 80 yards in the air. He'll be tested here.
He'll need every bit of that 80. This is it. Clock down to zero. That's not going to do it. Tip. Oh, my. Still tipped. It's going to be intercepted by J.J. Billingsley. Second year in a row, he seals the victory for Colorado. Colorado State fought their hearts out down to the wire, but for the second year in a row, they lose it in the end. Well, TBS Saturday Night College Football has been presented by Orbit. Stick around for the Dodge postgame report. Ernie Johnson will catch you up on all of today's action. Next week, Wake Forest in Nebraska. For Charles Davis, Craig Sager, I'm Ron Thulin. Thanks for watching. Stay tuned. Ernie Johnson is next.